the mics are on, I'm Jason.
And I'm Andy, but I don't like the way my mic was turned off.
It's because we always hear shuffling in the beginning.
And who are you?
Oh, yeah, I'm Brian.
There we go.
This is the exciting and new podcast, and our mics were just off.
I think we're all a little rusty. It's been a couple weeks. Brian's been away, and without Brian, we are completely helpless.
Back from Mazatlan?
Cozumel.
Cozumel. That's East Coast, I think, right?
Yeah, East Coast. And Belize.
Nice.
And that's not even Mexico, right?
No.
It's a separate country?
Yeah, the English-speaking country.
Right. English-speaking. That's my favorite kind, because that's the only language I speak.
I don't know if you'd like it there.
Well, I was going to say, I don't speak English that well.
It was a little run down. COVID hit them really hard.
But COVID's not going to last forever.
Is
COVID going to last forever?
Tourists hit them hard.
I think
hard.
So.
It's one of those kinds of places. I know that.
You'd better go to the West Coast then?
I've never been to the West Coast. I've done Tijuana. That's Mexico West Coast, but I've never done
that. That's like right south
it's
of
like
California, right?
It's like
right
under San Diego. Yeah. It's like San Diego South.
So it's almost like you're not leaving the country.
It's
almost,
insane
right?
How different it is between San Diego and Tijuana. It's a little imaginary line. And my God.
Next thing you know, you're watching a donkey.
My God, the differences. But they served me. I was 17 or 18 years old, and no problem getting beer there.
Probably didn't ask for ID or anything. No.
That was the big thing in Cozumel. Farmacia. Every stand was a pharmacy.
What did they probably sell like everything?
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Lots of dick drugs.
Oh well, we all need those. We're all old men. Well, Jason's not that old yet.
My stuff's still working, ladies. How you doing?
You all missed the exciting new podcast, and here we go. I can only imagine what clips Brian's going to pull out of this one. My dick's still working.
This should be interesting.
Brian, just say it so you can pull all three of ours in.
But even though it's not true, my dick's still working.
Did you say lurking? Is your dick still lurking?
The best part about that is I think even if we were getting monetized on YouTube, I don't think we could now. Because I think
canceled.
In the first 10 minutes, it's...
We have been canceled.
Today's three episodes are called Last of the Stubings, Million Dollar Man, and The Sisters. An original air date of February 4th, 1978.
All right. I know I've been accused of not being able to figure out which stories relate to the titles, but I got it. I'm good.
I think this one was easy. You got all three this time as well, right, Brian? There was one director, Jack Arnold.
Show?
Yeah, Jack Arnold directed the whole show.
Man, I didn't know that was possible.
We had five writers for those three stories. Yeah.
Five total
writers.
And they wrote the whole thing together?
It was like two wrote this one, then one wrote that one, then two wrote the other one, yeah.
Because that's too much writing for a group of five to write. They can't do that.
I think I would have loved that job, writing like a 17-minute episode, I guess.
Yeah, that's all you're writing. You're not even writing a sitcom. You're writing half a sitcom, or three
almost,
of a sitcom.
Yeah, because that's like, 21, 22 minutes for a sitcom.
So it's just...
You're just writing a short story and just seeing.
And honestly, not a very good one either.
And waking up the captain at 5 a.m.
So we get a girl and we get a boy and nonsense ensues and they get together. I just have to flesh out some details.
This guy's a burglar.
Oh.
Ooh.
Wow, we haven't done that. That's not, we have the big whiteboard. And burglar has not been done.
They've used dog recently, so we can't have that. Gary Berghoff and his dog. Yeah.
And didn't we just have another animal? Oh, we had the orangutan.
We had the orangutan. What was her name? Louise.
Brian's
his
not
mic's
on.
Not
Louise.
Something's never changed. 2 weeks on the seas, and nothing changes. I would like to point out.
So great. I looked right at him, too. He was like.
This is the 17th episode of the season.
Yeah, 18th that we've done, though, because we did the pilot.
Okay, but of season one, this is the 17th season episode.
This is the 18th episode of season one, yeah.
Well, let's just put it this way.
They
count
the two-parter as two episodes, that's why.
We're still in season one, and we have now met Stubing's ex-wife, his father, and now his nephew.
Yes.
Okay. I was thinking about that as we met him.
Courtney Stubing IV. It's a tall dude.
And what was his name? What was he kept calling himself something? Grout head?
Grout brain.
Yeah, he's tall. He's like 6'10 or something like that. He's gigantic. He reminded me of I knew it when I was watching the episode. Ricky Gervais's writing partner.
Stephen Merchant.
Yes. He reminded me of him a lot. As I'm watching him, I'm like, man, Stephen Merchant would play this guy in the movie. The movie version of this episode, he would play him.
If they redid this episode, like they're going to redo Different Strokes and Facts of Life, which I'm super excited about.
Facts of Life, too?
Yeah, you didn't read the article. You had to open if you opened it up.
I did not read the article.
Yeah, Norman Lear is doing, you know how they did the Jeffersons and All in the Family?
Is Norman Lear still alive?
Yeah.
What is he, 100?
Yeah, he's 99 or 100, one of them.
And does he need the money?
No, he just loves being on set. He says, great. This is really what he loves doing. So
that sounds like you got this from a Gilbert Godfrey interview or something like
I got this from reading that article.
Jason, you and I have known each other a long time. Have I ever read an article? I think I've commented in the past that if the headline doesn't give me all the information I need.
I probably should have led with end facts of life.
I need all my information given to me in the headline.
There's no way they do the bicycle shop episode.
They have to. And if you're not cast as Gordon Jump, I will be very disappointed. In fact, I got to be honest. Michelle and I were driving home the other day from work, and she was talking about – it was today. Jesus Christ, that was today. And this is going to be a long, stupid story.
That's great. I can't wait.
Babe Ruth from The Sandlot died today. I don't know his name. The guy that played Babe Ruth in the vision of Babe Ruth in The Sandlot died. Because we're driving home, Michelle's like, oh my God, Babe Ruth died. I'm like, really? Yeah. I'm hurt. I don't think he made it to the 40s. She's like, no, from The Sandlot. I'm like, oh, Babe Ruth was in The Sandlot? Anyway, we had the conversation. Yeah. I was like, and so she's like, I'm like, I don't even know who that is. So she went to his IMDb page, and there was just like 150 credits. He was one of those guys. One episode of Facts of Life, one episode of A-Team, one episode of McCormick and whatever the fuck.
Hardcastle and McCormick.
There you go, that thing, yeah. So I'm like, okay, yeah, he's one of those guys. And I was like, you know what would be a really cool thing to do? We have to create an IMDb page for Jason, that guy, and make him like bicycle shop patron in the Dudley Gets Raped episode or the he's shop steward at the Joe Gets Raped on Facts of Life episode. Every special episode, you know, the Michael J. Fox's friend dies in a drunk driving accident.
Not the one where he's on speed.
Or that one, yeah. Oh, yeah, he's Jesse's speed dealer in the speed episode, the I'm So Excited episode of Saved by the Bell. I was like, Jason needs to be in all those episodes. His IMDb page will be 150, and it'll just be like, oh, that episode. Oh, damn, this guy's in all those episodes. Because no one's going to go back and look and, oh, what patron is he? Which guy is he there?
Yeah, was he the one in the back at the bar there? I can't tell.
Town,
in the restaurant.
Town, what's the one in all the westerns? Like, townsperson.
Bar patron. That was always my favorite.
Bar patron. So we're 0 minutes into this.
Yeah, here we go. Let's get into our guest stars. Our first guest star, this is his only episode of The Love Boat, Frank Converse. He's playing Bill Thompson. He was known for a lot of westerns.
Yeah,
I had no idea
who this guy is. I kept looking him up saying, I think I know who this guy is, but I have no idea who he is.
He was in a lot of Western TV series in like from 1966 to 2012, like one episode here, two episodes here.
And as of
and
this
then
recording,
a couple of series he was on.
Still alive.
Yes.
Still alive.
Born in the 30s.
Yeah. Sorry, Dad. I know you were born in the 30s too when you're still alive, so we'll keep going.
Our next guest, she's in three episodes, two different characters. This character is not the reoccurring character, so it's the next two episodes she's on.
Oh, okay.
Be a recurring character. Pat Crowley, and she plays Noreen Badger. I had her here. She started working in the 50s and 60s. Again, she's also still alive. She was in Port Charles, 250 episodes of Port Charles, which I looked and saw was a spinoff of General Hospital.
It was a soap opera.
Yeah, spinoff of General
Hospital. Never even heard of that.
She was in one episode of General Hospital, but then 250 episodes
spun
of Port
her
Charles
off.
Spun her off.
Like when
they
put Joey Tribbiani in one episode of Married with Children and then gave him his own spinoff from that.
Dynasty, she did 9 episodes of Dynasty.
Now, was Dynasty a spinoff of General Hospital too?
I don't think so.
I mean, I know one's a daytime and one's a nighttime soap opera. But
yeah, I don't think that has any relation.
No, no relation.
She was also in an...
I'm not doing a General Hospital or rewatch.
I've never watched it to begin with.
I'm not doing that.
She was in Love Boat, The New Wave, or Next Wave, excuse me.
All right.
I mentioned Dynasty. She was also in one episode of Happy Days. One episode of Happy Days. I thought that would be nice.
Was she one of... Fonzie's girlfriends?
No, I think she was like a teacher or something like that. Yeah. She was also in one episode of the original Twilight Zone.
Which episode?
I didn't look up which episode.
Dude, now that is the kind of information I want. Don't look it up now. You should have looked it up before. That's what I want to know. Which Twilight Zone episode? Was she the one with Burgess Meredith when he crushed his glasses? Or was she in the one with William Shatner when the thing was on the wing?
I was like, oh, this will be cool. I'll just mention the Twilight Zone. Nobody will want to know anything else more about that.
I'm so sorry. You know what I mean? I'm so sorry.
But now
I've been drinking.
Now I have to look it up because.
What's her name? Mrs. Crowley? Mrs. Crowley.
Happy Days with Susan Patterson. Let's see. So
I think I worked with Susan Patterson. That's weird. I can't imagine that's true, but that sounds right. Sounds like it could be true.
That was too far.
Brian's listening, just like, how am I going to edit this shit?
All right,
down
she was in.
Sounds like something.
She's in the Printer's Devil, season 4, episode 8. A man sells his soul to the devil to save his failing newspaper and gets more than he bargained for.
They got more for they bargained for when they made a deal with the devil on the Twilight Zone.
You'll never believe who's in her episode, though.
Please don't tell me it's Burgess Meredith.
Meredith is in her episode.
Oh, I love it.
Burgess Meredith is one of the, Rod Serling. Oh, man, that's so, you son of a bitch.
So going forward, anytime someone's in the Twilight Zone, I will need to know what episode of the Twilight Zone they're in, even though I have no idea what that one is. I'm not a Twilight Zone
nerd. I'm not either,
but
I know you want it. I know you want it to be one of the two William Shatner ones.
I've seen
a bunch of
them, you know, every Memorial Day, Labor Day, whatever it is that they do them on. I'm like, I'm there. I'll watch a couple hours of that because what else am I doing? Watching the Love Boat.
It's so good, yeah. Love Boat's great. our next guest is Brett Halsey. He's only in one episode. He's playing Clark Tyler. He played Douglas Michelson in Godfather Part 3, but I never really watched Godfather Part 3. Douglas Michelson.
Yeah, I mean, I have seen Godfather 3 a couple times, but I don't know who that character is.
He was in Return of the Fly with a 1959 movie.
The Misfits song? Oh.
But that's where he got the song title from.
Return of the Fly. With Vincent Price, nice.
Yeah, and then he's been in a lot of like...
And I believe he's still alive, too.
Random 70s and 80s shows. He's been in a lot of like
one-episode, two-episode guys.
Yeah.
Vincent Price is still alive?
No, not Vincent Price.
I was going to say, I thought he died a long time ago.
He died a long time ago.
Did you know he was at the end of Thriller? That was him laughing?
He died right after or right before Edward Scissorhands came out. Edward Scissorhands came out. There was a lot of S's in a row there.
That was tough. I couldn't do it.
Edward Scissorhands was... Oh, fuck. Edward Scissors...
Just call it
Scissor.
Ed Scissor. Ooh, Scissor. He says
that
Scissor all the time.
That Johnny Depp and Winona Ryder movie.
Edward Scissorhands?
That one, yeah. That was his last movie, I think. I think he died either right before that came out or right after it came out. And I base that on... Maybe not. Because Vincent Price was not in this episode, so
I'm not looking that up. Vincent Price is on the Love Boat eventually, though.
Is he?
Yes.
Is it the Halloween episode, I hope?
I don't know if it's a Halloween episode, but Vincent Price does get on the boat. up next, one episode only, Peter Isaacson. He's playing L. Courtney Stubing the IV, the nephew of Merrill.
What's the L stand for?
I'm thinking Louise.
Louise. Well, he was Courtney.
How about Lenny?
Lenny, I like. How about Lemmy?
Lemmy works, but Lenny works because he could have been duh.
Where are the rabbits, George? That guy was tall.
He was in. He was in Grand Theft Auto. That was Ron Howard's first Roger Corman movie.
Oh, I thought you meant the video game.
Is one of Ron Howard's first movies that he directed.
Oh, really?
It was for Roger Corman. Yeah. Grand Theft Auto, it's called. He was also in BJ and the Bear, one episode. The movie The Fish That Saved Pittsburgh. Three episodes of Fantasy Island. One episode of Three's Company. One episode of What's Happening Now. an episode of Monsters Today and an episode of Full House. It's just, he only did 27 things.
He's got one thing going against him. He is way too tall. You can't cast that guy in a regular show because
you know
no
what
one's
he could. You know what he could have been good if he was like a Richard Kiel kind of guy. Like he played like he could have played
like the,
villain,
like the monster
like kind
of guy. Yeah, but he, I mean, he is so tall that when he was walking into the ship and he just walked by and he did his pratfall, I was like, oh my god, this guy's tall. Like he, I just noticed it right away because it's off-putting, his tallness. It's too tall. And he's not that much taller than me, but it's enough to make it really kind of weird.
It's an awkward tall, yeah.
I mean, he's like 4 or 5 inches taller than me. He's probably like, well, are you 6'7"?
I'm as tall as you.
I don't know. You come across as taller. You play taller on TV.
Our next guest, I talked about that. Okay, she's in 14 episodes.
Oh, it's got to be Marion Ross, right?
Nine different characters. Okay. Yeah,
nine different. So that means she's playing multiple episodes of multiple
characters. This first episode here, though, is not a recurring character. I looked. So.
And I think we've already discovered that when you play multiple characters, it's a two-parter, probably. That's probably what it's going to end up being, right?
Her last name is Stubing in some episodes. That's all I'm going to say.
Oh, spoiler alert. Really? Wow,
that's got to be after Vicky's. Son.
Can we fast forward to that episode? Now?
How many episodes of Happy Days do you think Marion Ross was in?
I mean, I want to think she was there for the whole run. So, how many episodes of Happy Days were there? 250? I know
I'm gonna give you a hint.
I know we've already done this with Anson Williams, so I don't remember.
Here's
now.
A hint: she was in every single episode.
Wow, 200. Was that on for 10 years, 253 episodes?
Brian?
I'm going to say one.
You should have said 254 because it's 255.
Get the hell out of here.
255 episodes. I was like, I thought you were going to get it there for a second. Like, he's got it. He did it.
Oh, I was trying to do math, and
that's
not
pretty
my
good,
strong
though.
Subject. Well, I was thinking 10 years.
If we could, we could probably manipulate it like a two-parter here to make it a one-parter. And I think when he jumped the shark, I think that was three episodes. I really think that was a three-episode.
Three episodes of that? Was he in the air for like an entire episode? He takes off at the end of the
first episode. I
think it
takes the whole first episode to get to California.
Just get there,
Okay, so now Marion Ross, I have some fun stuff here for her. She's been...
Also still alive.
Yeah,
born in the 20s.
She's been in her IMDb starts in 1953, and she's done stuff in 2021.
Good for her.
So she's still doing stuff there. Perry Mason, she was in an episode of Perry Mason. She was in one episode of The Brady Bunch.
I thought you were going to say Twilight Zone. I was like, you better have the episode she was in.
She was in one episode of The Brady Bunch.
Do you know it? You know it?
Oh, I know it, and I wrote it down for you guys, but I knew it, yeah.
I will not know it. I'm not going to get
it. It's a season one episode of The Brady Bunch. A boy and a girl in the family both come down with the measles.
Wow.
They call doctors to the, Mike calls his doctor.
Making house calls.
Yeah.
Wow.
Carol calls her doctor. So
and her doctor's a woman?
Her doctor's a woman. His doctor's a man. That doctor is also someone famous.
Wow, I don't remember that.
The doctor that Mike calls is the dad from Dennis the Menace.
Fred McMurray or whatever?
No, that's Henry. It was Henry Mitchell.
Oh, I'm thinking of...
you're thinking of My Three Sons.
Yeah.
But the dad from Dennis the Menace is the doctor that goes in.
Man, I would
but
not know him.
Marion Ross is the lady doctor.
And now I know the follow-up question is, what two kids got the measles?
No, I don't have
I
that.
I don't know the... I don't know that.
I want to say it was...
I'd say Bobby and Cindy because they were the youngest
Peter
ones.
And Marsh, Peter and Jen.
It's always the same.
I think it was the middle,
it's always the same level. Ones.
I think it was the two middle kids.
It's not going to be Greg and Cindy or Marsha and Bobby. It's always going to be the same level.
I would guess it would be the older ones because they're probably banging each other.
Oh, I was going to say they were born before vaccinations of the measles.
But Greg was also with Mrs. Brady.
Oh,
but that's in real life,
yeah.
Not on the show.
Yeah, who was banging on the show?
I want to say all the kids, maybe except Bobby and Cindy, probably didn't. I don't know if they ever did, but
you know, it wasn't the dad. What's his name? Reed Richards. Reed Richards. Fucking Fantastic Four. Christ Almighty, I've been drinking too much.
Do you think Oliver came in there and cleaned house?
How am I supposed to follow that up? What am I supposed to say?
I don't know. You could say Ambie Davis.
Is he a fluffer?
Pretty. You could say she was pretty or something, Ambie Davis, which I don't. I think she was on the boat, Ambie Davis. I'm not sure.
Oh. I'm going to go as far as to say that Marion Ross looked really good on this episode. And this is like during the Happy Days era. And I remember watching Happy Days and she was just like the mom on Happy Days.
Yeah,
and
but have you, I was looking did you ever at her, noticed there was
I'm
always...
I'm like looking at her and I'm like, all right. I'm like, Marion Ross in the 70s was like, okay.
There was
she's
always
not a 10, but she's
had,
not a zero.
She always had that flirtation with Fonzie,
she
too.
She sure, so. Certainly did. But, you know, Fonzie's living in her house for free, so Fonzie's going to put all the...
I'm not paying anywhere.
I mean, sure Fonzie was throwing it to her once in a while. I'd be like, Mrs. C, I'm short on the rent, but
Mrs.
I can make
C
it up
probably
somewhere
would
else.
Talk to Howard and say, he's okay. Not
he, he's okay.
Month,
he
yeah.
paid. He cleared out our cobwebs, and we're all
he,
good.
He hit some places that you couldn't hit. All right. Let's see. So
Marion Ross was the only one on this episode who I knew by name.
Marion
as far
Ross
as stars
also,
go.
She was also in Grand Theft Auto that I mentioned that
oh,
Peter
the,
Isaacson was in. The,
and
Ron
Howard.
Howard.
Yeah. But that was that Ron Howard post or during Happy Days? So, you know,
I think it was in the 70s. It was in the 70s. It was Happy Days.
She
yeah.
did her son on the show a favor.
She did one episode of Light Court, two episodes of Joni Loves Chachi.
Oh, wow.
One episode of the
play
new
the same character
the new that, Leave It to Beaver
on that Joni Loves Chachi
probably
those two
yeah.
episodes same character
she did four ABC after school specials
she was either buying drugs for someone or denying in, someone got raped or something like
she was
that.
In Love Boat Next Wave as Judy Glacken Ooh. And she was also Red Foreman's mom on that 70s
she certainly
show.
Was
four episodes yes. of that 70s show
she was also in. I'm going to say it was called Not Another Teen Movie. No. Not that one, but the superhero one.
Superhero movie. Yeah, it's
yeah,
in the top
yeah.
four, yeah.
Yeah.
It's in the top four. I,
she
I
was
the,
she
one.
Was, fuck, Logan right now would kill me, but it's Jake or Josh, Drake or Josh, whichever one was in that movie. It's his
oh,
mom.
Oh, from Drake and Josh?
Yeah, it's his mom.
The funny thing is, that was in Marion Ross's top four superhero movie.
That's stupid, but good for her.
Yeah, Drake Bell's in that one.
Drake, okay. She farts on camera. I'm sure it was a CGI.
Leslie Nielsen.
Yeah, it's one of those yeah. kinds of movies.
Kevin
it's
Hart.
A Leslie Nielsen yeah. movie. He's the president, I think. And at
Kevin
one point,
Hart.
He's naked saying...
Keith David, who's in everything.
Keith David, we're just watching him on Armageddon.
Jeffrey Tambor. Robert
awesome.
Hayes.
Love him.
Tracy Morgan.
Oh, my God. Can we do a superhero movie podcast?
Craig Bierko. He's been on Gilbert.
There you go.
Dan Castellaneta.
Homer. That was not my Homer impersonation. I just said Homer.
Pam Anderson.
Pamela.
Wow. Yeah, that's a nice cast.
I think that superhero movie had one of the best Leslie Nielsen post Naked Gun. You know, when he was doing all those crappy movies after Naked Gun, he was the president, and there was a gun that zapped people. Ah, fuck. You know what?
I'm so
off the rails yeah. on this. I don't even know.
Good news is I got one.
Fucking edit this out.
I've got one more person to announce for our guest stars, and then
please
we can
edit
get,
this out.
And then
I
can get
I mean,
the
listen, man. I don't want this on there. Like I was gonna go somewhere, but I lost it halfway through. It's
it happens, man. You're okay. The people out there love us.
I'm not talking until
shout
you,
out to
until
our
you, until you
shout out to our Facebook fan Mike B.
I know that guy.
You saw that post I sent.
Until you guarantee you'll delete it, I'm not talking.
I guarantee I'll delete something.
Fuck you! Until you guarantee that, you delete that.
I'll make it sound good.
You always ask like, you want us to take anything out? And we said, can you take this out? And the next thing you know, you list.
All of a sudden, I'm an anti-Semite. I'm like, I don't think I said that. My God, what are you cutting together here?
It's like in the trailer, the teaser trailer. For this week, when you said you weren't going to take a shower, that's not what you said.
I can imagine I said that, but there was one where you cut it together. It's like, or you didn't cut it together. I said it, but it's so taken out of context. Where I'm like, you people. I'm like,
this
I'm
one,
sure I didn't say that. But
this one has me doing Ava Gabor impersonation.
But you did that. You
I
did an Ava Gabor impersonation.
And after I said it, I said, "Take that out." I believe I said, "Take that out." Yeah.
Well, you can't take out the good things.
But when I stop a sentence halfway through because I lost my train of thought, that's not good. That's terrible. Who needs a drink?
Do you want to pause for a drink?
No, okay. No, I'm kidding.
Okay, we got Marcia Strassman, and she's playing Stephanie Lewis. She's famous for the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids franchise. She's the mom, Rick Moranis' wife in that. She plays Julie Cotter in how many episodes of Welcome Back, Cotter?
I honestly don't know how many episodes of...
Every episode of Welcome Back, Cotter. Gabe Kaplan isn't even in every episode.
I don't think Welcome Back, Cotter went on that long. I am going to say... 4 seasons, 25-ish episodes. So now I'm embarrassed. I have to do math. I'm going to say 100.
Brian?
I'm going to go low. And I'm going to say, I'm going to pick a number, though. I'm going to say 82.
Okay. Andy went a little bit over because it was 95 episodes.
Damn, man. Wow. Yeah. Close, though.
Yeah.
My math is
You off. Were right. Roughly. I think it was 4 seasons, so I think you were right. But, yeah, so she was in all those. She was in one episode of Patty Duke, I thought.
So why wasn't Gabe Kaplan in every episode? Did he go on strike or something like that?
I think he left in this last season. They wanted to do.
I know Archie Bunker's not in every episode of All in the Family because he went on strike. There were, like, 4 episodes at the beginning of one season where he's, like, at work. And it's just Edith and Meathead and Sally Struthers, like, sitting around talking about, why isn't Archie here? For, like, 4 episodes. Can you imagine watching that shit?
I mean,
you know what would be funny if Archie was here, but he's not. So
but you have to wonder what it was like back then too, because like nowadays that would have been all over the internet.
Yep. But no one probably even knew back then. Like, why is this episode?
They're like, it's another Archie episode.
Why is he in this one? Maybe he's sick. Right. Could he be sick?
Like, I hope he's okay. I also have. She was in the Paul Lynde Show 1 episode, but also she was in 6 episodes. All in season 1 of MASH. Mm-hmm.
She's one of the nurses.
Yep. I was wondering.
She hooks up with Hawkeye. Yep.
Nurse Margie Cutter, excuse me.
I remember when I watched MASH, I'd already watched Welcome Back, Cotter, and I remember like, I was like, oh, it's Mrs. Cotter.
You're like, okay, yeah, Mrs. Cotter getting some. All right, look at her. And she was also in the Love Boat 2 movie, 1977. That's the one that we haven't watched.
She was really young in that one.
77, yeah.
Was that Love Boat 2 Electric Boogaloo? Is that what it was called?
It looks like that one.
Is every sequel called Electric Boogaloo? Empire Strikes Back,
no,
Electric
this one's
Boogaloo?
A Search for Curly's Gold.
That doesn't hit as hard as
Electric
Boogaloo.
That definitely hits better. And it's Electric Boogaloo is always something everybody knows. It's almost like it's universal. Like, you could say that to anybody to get it.
I just read the other day, and when I say the other day, I mean like within this week.
What, you mean you read the headline?
And I did. So if this is false information, it was in the headline. Breaking, right? Breaking 2, Electric Boogaloo, was released the same year that Breaking came out. Like they did a sequel
like January,
within
the December?
Same calendar year. It was so cheap to make. They just said, roll another one out right now.
Do you think they just said, we got a lot of extra footage?
It's just one of those kinds of things. Just like piece something together and call it Electric Boogaloo.
Like, we just need to get a couple guys in here for a few lines, read a few lines.
But there was no Breaking 3, so I guess it didn't work.
Or they were just like, hey, that's a little much.
Too much Breaking.
Put the brakes on Breaking.
We're Breaking.
All right, so let's get into this episode. There was no elevator scene.
Get into this episode. It's horrifying to hear.
There was no elevator.
No Titanic scene. Jokes.
And, we didn't see much of the dining room, did we? I don't think we saw Captain's table.
I don't remember any dining room.
I don't think
room.
We saw the Captain's table. We definitely didn't see that.
Yeah, I don't think
Why'd
we did
Why'd you make
either.
It go green?
Oh, my.
We've gone to plaid.
Why'd it go green?
This'll let it out.
We're going green, though.
His stupidity.
Our podcast
we'll
has gone green.
Out. My stupidity doesn't get it out.
Please go check out our Patreon over at www.patreon.com/excitingandnew.
How many dollars have you gotten so far?
We haven't set that up. Our producer is supposed to do that.
Are people hitting that link going like, why can't I give these awesome podcasters money?
Four people out there trying to give us money, and then there's one person out there giving us a four.
Who gave us a four?
I don't know, but it's like somebody's probably pissed off at one of us. Because it has to be somebody we know. Somebody just being a dick to one of us.
I'm sure it's someone Brian knows. It's probably his mom.
I wouldn't be surprised.
and starring Andy's favorite, Lauren Hughes.
She looked really cute in this episode.
Yes, she did. Her eyes are really good, pretty. Right?
I mean, yeah. She's like 25 years old.
I know, but she looked like super
We're allowed
cute
to say she's
episode.
Pretty, Andy.
I'm saying she looks really good usually. It's a bunch of old men and a young girl. Like, yeah, she's going to look good against Captain Stubing's bald-ass
head. She's older than us.
This was interesting because Stubing had a pre-cruise meeting. He doesn't usually do this.
Well, he points out that.
Why is that the only crew that he had as part of the meeting?
The four people that we know is not everybody else?
Yeah, there's more on the ship that's part of that crew.
Well, you got your cruise director, your... Do you think he said,
"Hey, go run around with Doc and watch him give out some aspirin and some downers and some quaaludes,
sleep pills"?
He's giving out quaaludes
and rubbers.
It's the '70s. Come on.
Oh yeah, no rubbers. Sorry, AIDS wasn't invented.
So
yet.
He has this pre-cruise meeting talking about his nephew, who's going to be on this cruise, working this cruise actually, and midshipman Stubing. He says that he should be doing all duties, basically.
Starting at the bottom. And then he looks right Gopher right in the eye.
And he says, well, I'm not really the bottom. He's like, you're close enough.
I guess assistant purser is pretty low as far as...
So who's his assistant? Because we never see his assistant.
No, he's the assistant.
So
where's
the real
purser?
Yeah.
He's not assistant to the purser. He's the assistant purser.
I can't say that a lot. This is assistant purser.
I think I'm trying to do an Office joke there, but it didn't hit, really.
I didn't see The Office, unless it's the British version.
It's not. Oh, well, maybe it is.
Did you ever watch that version?
I never saw that.
That's really good. I recommend people. It. Ricky Gervais is great, though.
Can he come up with a different accent, version? Man? I'm tired. Everybody sounds like Sting. Fuck that, man. I'm tired of it.
I don't think the accents bothered me that much when I think about The Office. No, I'm just thinking.
I love British accents, except when they're doing medieval stuff, and I'm like, really? Again?
Or when you hear somebody that you've never heard them talk British, and then they do, you're
that's
like,
that's awesome.
What the hell
I
is
love
that.
Like, I love when all of a sudden you're like, oh, my God. The fat guy from what's his name? Fred Flintstone. The second Fred Flintstone was British. I'm like, he was Robert Baratheon.
Yeah, what can I think of it? I can't think of his name.
Michael Addy or something Addy.
I don't know. Producer? Yeah.
Something Addy.
But like he was British, but he was like in an American show and speaking American, and then all of a sudden he's in Game of Thrones like being
Apollo
all British.
From Battlestar Galactica is British.
Apollo? Oh, is he? Really? Oh.
A lot of people in the 100 are British.
that's true. Yeah. Australian.
Australian.
The two leads are Australian. No. And they're together.
Are they really even people?
Now, this 100, did you watch that when it was live on, like it was still airing?
I mean, I always watched it streaming, but it was on,
You
know, TV. I just never watched. I didn't have cable, so.
So his one viewership didn't count to the massive ratings that they were getting.
It won 7 seasons.
It was cheap to
what
make.
What channel
I'm
was
sure.
that? Was that Sci-Fi?
Not even that. It was CW. Like USA Network CW, or something like that.
CW. We love you, CW, if you want to sponsor us.
I'm going to go out on a limb here and say I've never, ever watched an episode of anything on CW.
You watched the first episode of The Wanderer?
I did. What was that, on Netflix or something by the time I watched it?
Wait, what was it called?
Probably.
The 100.
The 100.
Oh, The 100. I thought you said something else.
Oh, no. I watched the first one. I was like, this is the dumbest show I've ever watched.
Awesome.
And I've watched
The
Love
world.
Boat.
I know you guys make fun of the Love Boat, but you secretly enjoy the Love Boat. You know, you
have do. I done this for like 18 or 20 episodes? I'm sitting here doing this stupid fucking podcast.
And if I could pull up a text, I could read a text that we got earlier today that somebody really, really needed the podcast today.
Not because of the Love Boat. I had other things to talk about. I want to talk about Wheel of Time or Dune or Foundation or Shang-Chi. Or
was there any reaction to the Dune cast that
our
we did?
Special Dune podcast?
Not that I know of.
And I don't know how
not
to...
Not a lot of traffic there, huh?
I really don't know how to read Facebook because I keep getting notifications on Facebook that there was like two viewers or two views, and then it tells me, and I was like, I go to look at it, and it's just a bunch of numbers. And it's,
yeah, I can't
I
figure
no, I don't understand what's
either.
Going on there. It's just
all our fans are Brian's children, so luckily he's got a lot of them, but not enough to make us economically viable.
Well, I know we definitely have our... podcast special guest that we've had on. That episode should be coming up soon, right?
Oh, Anthony?
Yeah, that episode should be airing soon. I think he has his wife and one or two of her friends to listen.
Liking a Facebook page and listening to this bullshit for hours on end is a huge difference.
I know, but
Who would listen? Who would listen to this?
Tell me. I don't know, but like I listen to it.
I listen to it too. I hear my voice and I say, man, this is
tough. How funny is it to look at your podcast or downloading this morning and you look and you see yours next to it?
I'm like, that's right. I'm right next to my two favorite podcasts that download on Saturday nights also. Thank you. Pop Culture Leftovers.
You're like, ooh, all nine downloads.
And it's me and you and him and his daughter and his other daughter.
And then I remember to open up Spotify so it'll download there too.
I don't listen to the show.
Oh.
I listen to it when I edit it.
That's plenty.
I don't download
That's plenty.
You don't even download it? At least download it. Who cares if you listen?
Yeah. I have them all on my computer.
But we need the hits.
Yeah, we need to download, so have it on your phone. I mean, just what is going on here?
Oh, I didn't know that.
Are you kidding me? We could have 11 views. We could have 11 subscribers or something. I think we're almost up to 10 subscribers on YouTube.
Yeah, I haven't checked YouTube in a while.
Do we still like put our thing out on YouTube every time, like every week? Or
yeah,
whatever?
Yeah. Brian does that. Yeah.
I don't have YouTube on my phone. Is that a thing people still use?
I use it. I have the YouTube Premium.
Man, I wish someone would come up with a YouTube competitor. Oh my god, I hate YouTube so much.
Vimeo.
Yeah, no. I mean, a real competitor. I'll tell you, I mean, like, I want to listen to an album.
You want a competitor?
And not have a commercial during every motherfucking song. Oh,
you want a competitor
god,
for YouTube? Yeah, I got you. YouTube Premium. It's a fucking shit. Not one commercial.
How much do you have to pay for that?
I don't know. My sister does. I think it's only a few dollars a month.
I keep getting that ad for the trial.
For YouTube Premium. What did it get? Like free for like 30 days or something?
A week, I think.
I would give them a dollar.
If it was $2 a month, would you do it?
Nope.
$1.99 a month. 99 cents a month.
You don't hear that, right? My rubbing?
I hear a disturbance. I feel a disturbance.
Only if you hit the microphone. I hear Chucky's paws.
Are you trying to talk that way?
I keep turning my head because I do this, and I hear the cord
You're
rubbing
like,
on
Brian's
my...
talking.
Oh, that's rare. That barely happens. It's usually, I try to make eye contact with him anyway.
Hold on,
trying to make eye contact with him. Like, what do you think about that, Brian? And he says, let me find my button.
He says, olive shoes.
Olive shoes.
Or olive shoe. Is it olive you? You ever saw it where you just whisper it and it looks like I say, I love you, but you say like olive oil, or olive oil. And then it looks like you're saying, I love you.
It did look like you said that.
Can you cut this out?
I swear, the last like 15 minutes have to get cut out of this thing. It's just nonsense.
But the more we say that, the more I think he keeps it in. So that's what hurts the most.
As long as
that's
sounds
why this episode is going to be 4 hours long, and it's going to be garbage for 4 hours.
Have we even started yet?
No.
We did, and then we paused it because we were talking about the pre-cruise meeting, and then we went off track here because I don't think we even saw Noreen and Mrs. C walk in.
Let's go. Serious going,
but we're skipping right up ahead to here. But before that, I had Noreen and Mrs. C are staying in the
Fiesta Deck 132.
Oh, 136. 136.
I try to listen
that
to
was
that
close,
stuff,
yeah. And what was weird about them coming on is that guy Clark Tyler was right behind her and wanted to take her bag,
yeah.
Almost like he was standing right on top of them too, like in the line.
He
like,
was creeping on her.
Yeah,
he was right there.
And Mrs. Cunningham at this time was all about her. Ooh, check him out.
Yeah, right. Like her personality
changed
like
so
halfway
fast.
During
okay,
this.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, all of a sudden she was like, "Why are you with him?" I'm
like "You got to see other guys.
Weren't you pushing
to see other guys on this ship?"
It was
other
very
guys.
Strange how she changed
it happened
her personality.
So fast,
yeah.
Too, right. Okay.
There was no explanation for it either. It wasn't that she got hit in the head, became a coke fiend, whatever. No explanation for why all of a sudden her personality changed.
It was.
She started hanging out with Brian a lot because, my God, your personality has changed.
Okay, so let's see. I wanted to catch up on that.
Oh, I'll cut that out.
Yeah, that'll cut out. I love Brian. Cut that out. That'll be on the clip.
We also
on
got,
repeat.
We also
I love
got
Ryan.
Where Stephanie.
I love Ryan. I love Ryan. I love Ryan.
We got where Stephanie Lewis is staying in her.
Oh, that I didn't get.
She's the Aloha deck.
Oh, because she said I'm on A deck, and the other guy was on the B deck. I'm like, what's the B deck?
I don't know, but they went to the B deck.
But what's B like Aloha? As soon as you said I'm in the A deck, and that's later in the episode.
Is he in the Bon Voyage deck?
Oh, I don't know.
What would
Aloha
be a good
and B?
Aloha, which sucks because they never go to Hawaii, and there's always the Aloha deck.
Right? Yeah. You get to Mexico, and they're like, what the fuck's an Aloha? Hello. Hola.
Like, is this boat supposed to be here? What are you guys doing? It's like, okay, so yeah, A357. So Aloha deck, A357.
So does that mean like, so the Fiesta is 132 or whatever it was, 136. Is that floor one? And Aloha's floor three, like in a hotel. If a hotel tells you you're on 307, you're going to the
third floor.
So why wouldn't they put them in alphabetical order? Like Aloha's one, Buena Vista's two, Buena Vista.
You would think so, but at that time, Stephanie Lewis was having trouble finding her tickets, so she took all her stuff out of her purse and everything.
Surprised she didn't pull out a badge or a gun while she was doing that, but maybe I'm getting ahead of myself when I say that.
She said she had a system, and then Doc told her she must toss a heck of a salad, Doc said to her.
She said that, and I paused it while watching and looked at Michelle, and she looked at me, and I'm like, huh? And she said nothing. I'm like, yeah. She was not paying attention to the show at all, but I'm like, nothing? Nothing.
She's like, oh, he's got to watch this for 50 minutes. Like, oh, Christ, it's Saturday.
And you have no idea what I was watching right before I watched this. It's a real come down.
You want to tell us?
Breaking Bad Season 3, Episode 13, and then Breaking Bad Season 4, Episode 1.
Is there a reason why you're watching those two
Logan's
episodes?
Rewatching Breaking Bad, so every once in a while he'll come down and he's like, I'm about to watch the finale, and I'm like, let's go.
And you have to watch the first episode.
And then I was like, well, season three ends, that's the Gale season, and then season four begins after Gale, so.
That's some good stuff.
Oh, and I'm like standing up. There's the one scene in season three's finale where Mike goes and shoots up that Chinese supplying place, and he walks in with his gun up, and he's looking at the guy, and the guy's got his hands up, and he raises his hands up so Mike knows where to put the gun up against the wall to shoot the guy that's on the other side of the wall. Like, I forgot how awesome the show was. Oh my God, Breaking Bad!
I was
Bad,
actually
so
thinking
awesome.
Of doing a rewatch of that. Sometime soon.
I'm not doing a rewatch because I've only seen maybe like out of the first four seasons so far. I've seen like five episodes.
I only watched that through once, so I've only seen it once.
Yeah,
maybe, you know when it might be good to watch after this next season of Breaking Bad, of Better Call Saul?
When it's all done.
When it's all done, then go right into Breaking Bad. That might be
But then they're going to announce a prequel to that.
They're done. I think Vince Gilligan needs to write something else now.
Yeah, I mean, this has been his life's work.
I'm surprised that Vince Gilligan
I don't think
was
he's that
part
involved
of Better
in
Call Saul. No, I think he is.
He's like an executive producer, but I don't think he's
I think he writes a lot of the episodes, too.
I don't think he's the main guy. My guy.
Hey, guy. Come on, guy.
Oh, my God. But.
The writing on that was really
And
good.
Then season four starts with, like, that's the box cutter episode.
Oof. What a great show, man. Love Boat. The Love Boat.
Is anybody from Breaking Bad on the Love Boat? Mike Ehrmantraut's an old man.
Yeah, because he was Banks. An airplane in 1980.
Jonathan Banks should be on the show. At the very least, Bryan Cranston's probably
Bryan
a little
Cranston,
young.
You know, I did see Tom Hanks is on.
I don't know why
young
I got excited
Tom Hanks
about
that. Is okay, there.
Well, I care about Tom Hanks being on here. He's not Breaking Bad.
No, I'm just saying, like, I'm thinking of some people that are young. So around that age, Tom Hanks' age could possibly be on their 60s. Yeah, but I'm not sure if he would be a good, Jonathan Banks would be a good. A good person on the boat, I think. I want to look that up, but I won't look it up in the middle of this episode.
Listen, Stubing, I don't care what we're doing on this cruise. I just want to make sure that the meth is going to flow off this boat. Gus gets his cut, and then everything's okay.
That was like
I don't even know if that's a really good Mike Ehrmantraut, but
no,
like,
that was to me.
In
was
my
a,
head, that's Mike
it was
Ehrmantraut.
A Stubing, and then when he went up, it was Mike. When he got,
but he
up,
does that.
Yeah.
Listen, Walter. I don't even know what we're doing out here in the desert, but because he's got like that Philly kind of accent going.
Yeah, but he definitely good. Does good like this.
He's so good.
I
keep telling Logan, he's better in Better Call Saul. Like his
is Logan enjoying Breaking Bad?
Oh, he loves it.
Yeah,
yeah, really loves it. My phone keeps buzzing.
Such a good. That's such a great show. All right,
let's cancel this.
Brady's watching that now too.
Yeah, they Brady, Logan, and their friend Dominic are all watching it.
They're doing a podcast,
but they're all on different parts. Logan's on season 4, Brady's on season 3, Dominic's on season 1. So they've all decided that. I told them that the last 4 episodes of the show, you gotta watch it together. You have to watch it and just sit and watch like Ozymandias and New Hampshire and all those episodes. Just sit and watch like
four or five episodes. So good, man. Oh, wow.
Just sit and watch like 4 hours together. So make sure you're all together, get caught up together, and watch it all together. Because
are they gonna do that?
Yeah, they're doing that.
That sounds good.
Brian's son came into work the other day and he was talking about where he was, and I said to Logan, I'm like, now you know how I feel. Because Logan's always like, I'm like, oh, is this the part where I don't want to say anything because I might spoil something for you. And he'll look at me because I'll just mention a character. I'm like, is Kristen Ritter still in the show? And he's like, what do you mean still in the show? I'm like, I'm sorry. I'm like, I'll leave the room. And so Brady comes into work the other day and Logan and I are talking. And Logan's like, oh my God. He's like,
yeah, Logan's the furthest in.
Logan's like,
right?
Gus just showed up. And Brady's like, who's Gus? I'm like, never mind. Never mind.
I asked Brady the other day, I said, what do you think of the laundromat? Because I knew what episode it was. And he was like, you can't say stuff like that because I just saw the laundromat for the first time 15 minutes ago.
Logan also says that my reaction to things lets him know how.
What
if someone's gonna live or die, like he can just tell,
see it
like
on his face, like when he's talking, you say a certain character, and you're like,
if I'm just like, oh man, I'm like, oh, that character's so good, that makes it. He's like, oh, they're dead. And Skylar, they were talking about her the other day, how much they hate her. Like, can they just write her out?
Oh,
like,
yeah. What did they think of Walt Jr. Flynn?
They really had nothing to say about him. I'm like.
Brady said he didn't mind.
Is he just eating breakfast? Because that's all he does.
I think he's a ridiculous character. Ridiculous.
I hate everyone but Jesse and Walt.
Can you cut this out and make it our own Breaking Bad podcast?
Sure.
Wait, come on, man. I mean, Mike is an awesome character.
Oh,
Saul is an awesome character.
I like Mike and Saul too.
Gus.
I mean, of Walt's family.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, Walt's family. Well, yeah.
Is Hank part of his family? Because I love Hank.
Nah.
Oh, Hank.
I mean, he's part of his family, but I don't.
Sorry about that.
Sorry, Hank. The other day, Logan.
Hank deserves better.
Like, I don't want to spoil Breaking Bad for anybody that came to this Love Boat podcast to hear us talk. They're like, wait a minute, Breaking Bad? That's like 20 years from now. I haven't even started that show yet, but the episode where the cousins found Hank at the in the parking lot.
And they're walking through the parking lot, you just see their boots.
Well, it was just so funny because I'm watching the episode and Hank gets on the call. He gets in his car and he calls Marie and he's like, hey, I'll be home in a couple of minutes. You need me to pick anything up from the store? And Logan looks at me. He's like, he's not making it home, is he? I'm like, I don't even know what you're talking about. And then you just see the boots start coming in and the one guy's dragging the axe behind him. I'm like, Jesus Christ. I'm like, I forgot how intense this is. Because I'm like, I know what happens. I know who survives that thing. I'm like, oh my God, I'm like, this is going to be brutal when this goes down. It is so brutal. Oh my God, man. Hank did not get his just due in that show.
Nah, man. And
Gomi.
Again, not spoiling too much when Hank realizes that certain something when he's sitting down and he opens that.
WW.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. Wow.
Man,
you're really making me want to watch.
I could do
now.
A Breaking Bad podcast without rewatching that show.
Got to guess what we look at the name of the episode and we have to guess what it was about.
Oh, I bet I could do really well at that if you just said like Ozymandias or Box Cutter or because New Hampshire. Oof. But the last episode's called something like it's finale, but it's not. It's like not finale.
It didn't have the name of that song in it. Blue.
Oh, Crystal Blue Persuasion or whatever.
No,
it wasn't
Crystal Blue Persuasion. It was. Sugarloaf, something blue. Mm. Brian?
I don't remember.
I thought it was like finale, but not finale. Like some other way of saying that. Maybe not in English.
Finny? Finn? Was it just Finn?
It might have been Finn.
Flynn? Was it just Flynn?
Flynn.
Sugarloaf was the band, I believe, right? Sugarloaf.
Bow, bow, bow.
Oh, that was Green-Eyed Lady. song at end of Breaking Bad, right? You know, so many questions, you put them out there. You just got to be simple with these questions sometimes, and they come up. Yeah, right there. Badfinger. Baby Blue. Baby Breaking Blue. Bad. Now you're out to edit this part out, won't he?
That's where he's like rubbing the containers and stuff like that.
So good.
I said to Logan when he was watching it today, when we were watching those episodes, I was like, there's going to be a scene in this show where I remember I physically was just like, sorry, I'm coughing, not choked up. Like, I was like, I've played that on YouTube many times, and it's the most pointless scene. There's nothing to it, but it's in the New Hampshire scene where the bar, where he calls the DEA at the bar. And yes. Then he sees the gray matter people on TV, and then they go back to the bar, and they just start panning down the bar, and they're playing the music, boom, boom, and they get to the cup, and it's just sitting there with the tip. I'm like, can we just go to the next episode now, please? I got so
they
wound
split
up
that last season too, which was
it was one of those eight and eighters. Like,
I need this
move.
They're doing that with this final season of Saul, I think. As well.
Are they?
Yeah. Which just seems like
I'm so glad I rewatched that season of Soul. Well, I watched it when
I
broke my back
that song
the other
too, because he has to cut that out now.
Yeah, this whole we've been talking about
Breaking Bad for way too long,
20 minutes.
I think it's safe to say that we're three people that would recommend Breaking Bad to anybody out there that hasn't seen it.
I hate people that are those kinds of people. You don't even know what TV is like until you watch X show, whatever it is.
Yeah.
But man, Breaking Bad is the best fucking television show
of all
time.
That's one of those.
And I hate that Michelle hasn't watched
it. That's one of those things where people always say, like, you know, there's always people that talk about, how great The Wire
and
was.
The Wire is
and they do it The Wire
shows,
and Breaking Bad are the two shows that happens with the most that you hear people.
And the 100.
Yeah. No one's ever said about The 100.
And it's funny because we were just talking about shipping containers upstairs with Michelle. And that season 3 of The Wire has a lot to do with shipping containers.
Oh, does it really? Like shipping
season
cocaine
two,
or something like that?
Actually, season 2 into 3 has a lot to do with shipping containers.
You finished
really,
The Wire?
I finished it,
What do you think?
I think I enjoyed it.
Overall, you enjoyed it, huh?
I'm surprised.
Because I cannot get through season 1. I don't think it's that good.
I'm surprised that I stopped when I kept stopping because it gets really good. And even when Littlefinger joins the cast.
Peter Baelish, you mean?
Yeah.
Pietro?
He's really good in it, but there's so many great characters in that. It's just
is Idris Elba in that?
Idris Elba's in that. Yep. Idris Elba. That was one of his biggest. I think that was when he really broke out. Huh. I think because that was the early 2000s or something like.
I'm never gonna watch it. There's so many shows that I want to watch.
Would you watch it or have you ever watched it?
I'm not a big police show
and that's usually my problem. And I watched the first season, I think, or I just stopped watching it halfway through. I was like man,
it's weird because like the first season's about like a lot of it is mostly about the kids down and selling the drugs.
I remember that they had the couch there in the compound that they were selling
the drugs.
The second
season is
like
the ports, the docks and stuff like that. The third season is a lot of like the politicians get involved. Third and fourth season are like politicians and everything like that. Littlefinger running for mayor. And
but he's
then,
British. Can he run for mayor of Baltimore?
And then the fifth season it has a lot to do with like the newspaper industry.
Fake news and stuff
like
that.
Yeah, and that was really good how this one guy started lying about a story while the cop was also making it up. So this reporter was saying he got a call from this cop who was faking this story. It was really ridiculous. One thing I really disliked about The Wire, season 5, the serial killer arc that they took, because they were having trouble getting money. They were going after these drug dealers, and they were following the money, and that was leading them into politicians and everything. So they kept getting shut down. So it's good. I mean, again, I don't think you'll watch it, but
I'll never watch it.
I would put it in. I'll put it in my top 20.
Get the hell out of here! After all this, after all it's said and done,
I'll put it in my top 20 non-comedy.
Non-com.
Yeah, non-comedy.
I don't like that.
Where's his 100 in your top?
100 is his one, number one.
Top 100?
It's definitely in the top 10 of sci-fi.
Fucking ridiculous, man. It is a terrible show, and I watched 1 hour of it. I knew it was going to be shitty.
Did you like the Planet of the Apes television series?
The one from the 70s?
Yeah.
Yeah. I was a kid. I've never watched it since then.
Would you compare that to the 100? What do you think?
I don't. To tell you the truth, now I don't even remember what the 100 was about. I remember it was a bunch of kids, and they got sent down to a planet, and it was like a CW show in
Earth.
Oh, was it Earth?
Yeah.
Oh,
I know we talked about this, but
you know, it was that planet. I've been to that planet
because it's almost Thanksgiving and then the holidays. But can we do the? Can we do the Star Wars holiday special where we do that? Can we do that? Do you want
to
do that?
I would love to do that. The actual real holiday special?
From 1978.
Should we watch it together?
That's what I was going to say. Do we watch that one together, then do the podcast? Yeah, or do you want to watch it
separately? Should we watch it together and do the podcast at the same time?
I think it might be difficult to watch it and do it, right?
Can we have headphones in and sound coming out?
So, yeah, we'll have a different sound.
I think it might be tougher that way because pausing it and saying shit, I think it would be more difficult.
Did we do that? Have we been known to pause stuff? Oh, look, we're 37 seconds in the Love Boat.
We're over an hour.
4 minutes in. 4 fucking minutes in.
We're an hour and 7 minutes.
I got to pee. I know how long we've been down here.
Look,
I
could zip through this and just be like, Julie does this. Gopher does this.
I don't want to zip through this at all, but this was one of those kinds of episodes where, except for the nephew thing, everything else was kind of like standard Love Boat.
Take out the 15 minutes of Breaking Bad. There's another 10 minutes, I think, before that we can take out. So we're only at about 25 minutes. And I was expecting to be long on the introductions just because we didn't know those people. And I had some stuff to go with Marianne Ross. You know, I can't not do Happy Days.
Oh,
stuff,
she was the most important part of the show.
Yeah.
I mean, that's it. I mean, Mrs. Carter's fine, but
I was
going
to say, she's no Mrs. C.
But she's it. That's it. The two women. That's weird.
Yeah, and that's why it made it tough. It made it tough to like, oh, that's Clark Tyler, that guy that likes Pat Crowley, who's Mrs. Cunningham's sister.
Because you're like, can I call them by their other shows?
And that's
that
the
I
thing. Like,
by?
I couldn't call these people by other names because I was like, who the hell's this guy? What's he been in? I don't know any of these westerns that he's been in. And then it was
one of those kinds of shows. It was definitely difficult to discuss the people.
Right. Yeah, I was like, what am I going to call this person? Obviously, Mrs. C, you knew that. But
so where are we? Do you
right here?
Where
this
does
is
leave off.
Right here is where this is where L. Courtney Stubing just tripped. Just tripped coming into onto the ship here, and his suitcase basically explodes open, and we just get the dumb introductions here. They asked them like
I gotta get back into this. I'm sorry.
You're right. This was a hard episode.
There's not a lot of frivolity. Although something's coming up very, very soon that I noticed.
Well,
in
we find out the names, some of his nicknames. They asked what his nickname was.
He kept saying like Grouthead or something like
that.
Oh, Zitface. What they call you in high school is Zitface. He keeps smacking himself in the head.
Grout brain.
Okay. I want Brian to
see this.
Come over here a little bit because, all right, we met Stubing and he's like, this is my crew and it's all going to be.
Stubing gets
pissed off. Watch Stubing walk up the stairs after this. He looks like he's injured.
He limps.
Look how slow he's.
Was he faking a
I don't
limp
know.
Going up the
stairs? I was
step?
Like, why is Stubing like not making it up the
because
stairs?
Because nothing
that
else
fast?
Comes from that.
Nothing.
We don't
all.
Talk about that later.
When he was walking up, I was like, why is he like limping up the stairs?
Now, I looked in the trivia and stuff like that. There was nothing saying he got injured or anything like that. So, but again, he doesn't.
Then you get a body double.
He doesn't limp anywhere else for the rest of the, like, through the episode or anything like that.
He might have had a hard on.
Well, he did get hugged
because his 7-foot-tall nephew just hugged him.
But, like, how did, like, Stubing not say anything about the open suitcase? And, like, how he was saying hello to these people was just so obnoxious. And then he takes the lightest bag from this lady.
This kid has anger issues. As we'll find out later,
he has no common sense.
Everything is always angry. Like, you can be a klutz, and that's fine, but His anger
like,
is...
Look how tall he was on the Bon Voyage.
Yeah, he is
he
so tall.
He towered over everybody.
Do we know how tall he was? Did we talk about that?
We didn't. I didn't look up his height. You said he was probably about 6'10", right?
He looks so tall.
There's Bill. What a nice guy he seemed to be, right?
He is a nice guy.
He just made a wrong decision. But is it really a wrong decision?
You rob from a bank?
If you could get away from it?
Don't we all try to rob from banks every day?
If you could get away from it. I mean, that's a nice bag, too. I don't know. Something about that bag I like, the red and black.
The unlocking was weird, isn't it?
He's got a lock on it. And why would you carry $1 million in cash? And then, he's just lying.
Also, why would he not have that in there better? I'd have that stacked
rubber band at least.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah.
Why have you not like converted that to something a little more manageable that you don't have to just carry $1 million
and $100?
You know how many bills
equal
$1 million?
If you guys want to sponsoring us.
You know how many $100 bills you have to get to be $1 million?
Yeah.
A lot. I'm sure there's a mathematical equation that you can do.
Is it 1,000?
Is it?
Is it 1,000 hundredths?
Yeah, a million is 1,000. Well, no, that's 100,000. So
it's like 1,000,000. It's 1,000,000 hundredths to make $1 million. It's a lot. I know. You're all like looking at me like I'm the dummy, and fucking Jason pulls out a calculator. Hear that? All those zeros.
What were we trying to
divide by 100?
Subtract 2 zeros off that.
10,000 $100 bills.
I was off by
1 0. Glad that you had to bring in a calculator to figure out this tough math.
Well, I said 1,000 for some reason. That wasn't
so. That guy's
right.
got a suitcase full of 10,000 $100 bills.
Do you think 10,000 $100 bills could fit in that suitcase?
It probably weighs 10,000 pounds. It doesn't weigh 10,000 pounds, but it probably weighs 100 pounds.
He poured that
it probably
over
weighs
her head
a lot.
Little bit, too. Spoiler.
Yes, straight out of Indecent Proposal or one of those movies. Well, 10 years later.
So then it's Indecent Proposal stole it from there, right? Here we get a shot of F-136.
Oh, this is the Fiesta deck.
We're on the Fiesta deck.
We're at Mrs. Cotter's. Place. Oh no, we're the Mrs. Cunningham. Sorry,
Mrs. C and yeah, Pat Crowley.
Mrs. Cotter's on the Aloha deck. So these girls. So Mrs. Cunningham's a widow.
This is where we find out how she. And this is where Mrs. Cunningham says she needs to find a guy.
Yeah,
she's basically
Mrs. Cunningham's a widow, and Mrs. Crowley is a
Mrs. Crowley.
She's a spinster. She'll be called that later in the episode. So she's a
yeah,
woman that's
I think
never married,
it was Mrs.
I guess.
C that called her that, too, right? You've been a spinster all your life, she said, yeah.
I hate to make it all down to looks, but this is a good-looking woman. She should not be spinstering at 50 years old or whatever she is here.
I thought she was very pretty. Yeah.
So she should have been able to get a guy. So there must be some underlying condition here that...
Do you think she's like a weird cat lady or something?
Or smelly vagina or something like that. I don't know.
She has
isn't that what Jennifer Aniston has?
Does she really? Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. I like her.
Allegedly.
Is that a slanderous there? Is Jennifer Aniston going to sue you?
That one's out, right? That one comes out.
I'll take that out of the podcast, but it should be in the teaser trailer.
I think he can still get sued if it's in the teaser. Jennifer Aniston's got a sticky vagina.
Wait, are we really going to lie and put stuff in the teaser that doesn't make it? They're skeet shooting. Sorry.
The composite shot again. I love it.
That's got to be the same skeet, right, each time?
Mr. Brady shot that thing 20 episodes ago.
That's what
ago.
I wanted to say. Mr. Brady shot at that, too.
But wait a minute. We got to take out the Jennifer Aniston as a stinky vagina thing, right?
Why, you think she's going to come on the show?
No, but I mean, like, if the show does take off.
How awesome would it be if she came on just to, like, dispute that? Like, why do you guys think that?
I was like, because you can't keep Brad Pitt and you can't keep Justin Theroux.
Yeah, but I will tell her
once and for all that her and Ross were on a fucking break.
They were on a break, for sure. But that doesn't mean Ross should be sleeping with someone the next day.
I mean, he didn't plan it. He just ended up happening. That girl liked him, that she was the copy girl. They were talking about her before.
The copy girl, I know, you know. But that's rough, man. You just broke up with your girlfriend. You're going to sleep with somebody else.
I know, and it's Jennifer Aniston.
It's Jennifer Aniston at her prime. She's like season three Friends. Jennifer Aniston is. There's never a better Jennifer Aniston.
Now,
there's not a lot of better looking women on the planet at that age.
Horrible Bosses one. She was.
She's. I think she's still very attractive now, even in the morning show. She's in her early 50s. Yeah. But
I haven't watched that.
I like it. Yeah. Well, it's got Steve Carell in it, so you probably wouldn't like.
He's so on. You know what?
He's not so funny in this, so it doesn't. It's not a comedy.
Which makes me mad because I just watched a documentary on the Dana Carvey show.
Okay, he's like the head writer
Hulu
on that.
Really good, and like Louis C.K. was one of the head writers too. Like, but Steve Carell and Stephen Colbert,
okay,
were both on there, and they are very funny on that show. Some of the sketches that they do on there, and it's also where the ambiguously gay duo.
Oh, first, really? That came from
there?
That's
where it first aired, yeah. And then Robert Smigel took it to SNL after...
like, did he create it for that show and just like...
Yeah, and but then he's like, this show's too good to not be on TV, which is great. That's a great... And that's Steve Carell and Stephen Colbert doing the voices of that.
Oh, really? Even on Saturday Night Live?
Even on Saturday Night Live, yeah.
I did not know that. I did not know that.
I did not know that.
Johnny Carson, I got it.
All right, now, yeah. I was hoping for a...
yes, sir.
okay, so
cut that together so it sounds like Johnny and Ed, please.
Yeah. Okay, I can do that.
And then the skeet.
This is a fucking
skeet
nightmare,
shooting
man.
Here.
I don't even know how you edit this thing. I really don't.
I don't even know what this one. What you would like? What do you say about this? Check this episode out. They talk about the Love Boat. Do they?
Do you like Breaking Bad? Do you like The Wire? Listen to our Love Boat podcast.
Jason, who formerly hated The Wire, couldn't get past season three. Now
you couldn't season three. You made it all the way to season three and stopped watching it.
Yes, I did the same thing with Boardwalk Empire.
Dude, that is not a ringing endorsement for me to ever spend that much time watching a show.
But I know. But this time, it took me a couple times. But this last time that I watched it, I enjoyed that all the way through. I was excited to watch an episode. When an episode would end, I'd be like, "What time is it? Oh, it's only 2:30 in the morning. I can get another episode."
Yeah,
in
I'm so out now. Knowing that you made it through three episode seasons and didn't even like it. I mean, I hate hearing like you got to get through the first three episodes and then it kicks in on episode four.
But
fuck you. Show me the shit that I want to see in the first episode. That's with Wheel of Time. I was about to give up. I'm like, nah, this is not my thing. And then it kicked in the last 20 minutes of that first episode.
What part gave it to you for Wheel of Time? You could say. I don't think that's a spoiler, right?
What do you mean, what part?
You said what part? There was a part you were about to turn it off, then something happened that made you keep it on. What was that something that happened?
The whole last 20 minutes of the episode.
I was wondering if it was a specific thing.
But
that's
he hasn't
all, yeah.
watched it yet. I don't want to
oh,
spoil
I thought
it
he
for
did.
Him.
I thought he said he did. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I haven't.
My apologies. I thought he said he watched it. That's
but it's
why.
The last 20 minutes. Like, as soon as, like, that
I get what you're
thing
saying
happened,
that.
I was like,
I get what you're
wow,
saying with the last 20
okay,
minutes,
in.
But I thought we could talk about it. But
I was
no,
really
kind of,
like, sitting there going, like, is something going to happen? Because the only show I want to watch where nothing happens is Seinfeld.
Oh, so good. I'm actually.
Rewatching that now too.
I've been rewatching that, like to fall asleep sometimes too. I put a couple episodes on before I go to sleep because I cut cable now. So
what's that on now? Netflix. Like that?
Yeah. So I'm like, usually the stuff like I would fall asleep to like Family Guy or King of Queens or something like that. I got.
So when you're going
on,
to sleep and you put on TV, you have to actually like think about it. You have to be like, I have to put something on.
Yeah, but I can putting on Seinfeld's good because then if I like fall asleep during an episode, it's not like
I get what
I
you're saying, but
that.
Like. I usually just go to my Sling, and that's TBS, TNT, Comedy Central, Cartoon Network.
See, I don't have Sling. Can I use your Sling password?
Sure.
That work?
I'm sure you could. I'll give it to you.
All right, yeah.
It's A...
funny O and A, Opie and Anthony bit one time. Rich Voss was on, and they were talking about... He put something on his Twitter, so they were pulling it up, and they were asking him what his Twitter name was, and he gave his password. On the air.
So everybody just start hacking the shit out of him? That's awesome. I remember years and years ago, one of the podcasts I listened to all the time, like they've been going on for like 10 years. The guy was like, HBO does not care if you share your password. This was not the HBO Max thing. This was at HBO Go, probably when that first started. And he was like, HBO, the CEO has said he doesn't care if you share username passwords. And he... blatantly just said, my username is this and my password is this. Use it if you want to. And like the next week, I remember he was talking about it. He was like, I haven't got
suspended.
No. He was like, nothing's come of it. He's like, if you're all using my password, that's awesome. Go at it. Nothing came of it for him. So
that's pretty
nothing ever did.
Yeah. I mean, HBO Max, I know you could share passwords.
I wonder what their
You can max out how many streams.
Yeah, I wonder what their max is. Like, Netflix is not much.
I think Netflix is 4.
See, I share mine with my sons, Michelle and I, the kids, and then her parents. And I think my parents, too. So if it just so happens that Michelle's parents, my kid that doesn't live in this house, and then Logan watches something, and if Michelle and I just want to watch Netflix, yeah, we'll get bumped out. I've gotten bumped out of Netflix. Fuck. Netflix before.
That's a tough one.
It's not a tough one.
I was just trying to say it in my head,
it's
and I don't think I can say it.
Not a tough one. Oh, man. So has anybody ever drank bourbon after a martini and two beers and tried to do a podcast? Because
this is it.
That's where I am now. And I've been thinking this whole time. I'm like, I need a drink. I need a bourbon or a beer. Not a martini. That would end this podcast. I'd piss the table. You guys would have to go home.
Oh, do you have to go pee now?
I kind of have to do. Do you see me grabbing myself? I'm like, grabbing myself down here.
You're doing a wee-wee dance.
I'm kind of.
Do you want to pause it to use the restroom?
I want to pause it. How many minutes are we into? How many seconds are we into this?
We moved a little bit there.
Brian, I hope you can cut this thing together, man.
This is where Stephanie here.
Stephanie
says she wants to be Angie Dickinson after her.
And
after
I did not get that reference. I mean, I know the name Angie Dickinson,
she was Big Bad Mama or whatever in one of those old movies, I think. And
is that what she's referencing here?
And she's supposedly like hot. Like,
okay,
Angie Dickinson was one of those.
I know what Angie Dickinson looks like, but when she said, "I'm Angie Dickinson shooting the gun," I'm like, I don't get that reference.
You know, don't think Angela Lansbury.
I knew she wasn't doing that.
That's a different.
What's his face wasn't on yet. Murder, She Wrote. Although she didn't shoot anybody on that show.
No, she wrote it though. She wrote all about it, didn't she?
Did Angela Lansbury write that show?
I don't think so. I never watched it. No. I don't know what it was. I don't know what she solved murders. Is that what it was?
I believe Angela Lansbury's still alive too. She's probably like 105
years old. I don't think
she's
alive.
Angela Lansbury, if you're alive, call in.
One of my favorite Seinfeld lines, George asks his dad, he says, "How old would Aunt Bebe be?" And he goes, she never would have made it.
She never would have made it.
So you're looking up if Angela Lansbury is alive?
I just want to know she is. She is.
She's still alive?
95.
Wow. That's like Dick Van Dyke's 95.
She doesn't look a day over 92.
I did not. I would have guessed.
Marion Ross was born in 1928. She is 1928 minus 2021.
92, 93.
You do the math.
I just did, didn't I?
Yeah. 92,
what did you say? 72?
92 or 93, yeah.
Wait, so you minus the bigger number against the smaller number.
She's like 92.
Okay.
How old is Marion Ross?
Stop yelling at me. Why is he yelling at me?
93.
You said 92. You're close.
I said 92 or 93.
You said 93 first.
Remember, it was $10,100 bills.
10,000. You know how many 10,000 bills that is? It's 100. But you know how many $100 bills that is? Who's on the $10,000 bill?
That's a good question.
I think it's Samuel Chase.
Who is on the $10,000 bill? The $10,000 bill featuring the portrait of President Lincoln's Secretary of the Treasury, Salmon P. Chase.
Wow.
Goddamn right. I know my shit, man. I'm a history guy. I know that stuff.
That was good. That was really good.
I don't think I said Salmon. I think I said Samuel, but I'll
give you that. That's
because who names their kid after a fish? Salmon?
I might be saying it wrong. It could be Salmon.
Well,
Salmon.
I say Salmon even when it's spelled Salmon. I say Salmon, but I know a lot of people pronounce it Salmon.
Salmon Rusty or Salmon Rusty.
I think Salmon. I think that's more Muslim.
Remember when he was
sounding on
the curb?
That was great with the fatwa.
He said, "Let me tell you some fatwa sex."
It's Salmon Rushdie still alive.
I know.
There's been a fatwa on that guy's head for like 40 years, man. Good for him.
And he's not in hiding if he's doing TV
shows.
He's
right? Not hiding anymore, I don't think.
Yeah, so that was our skeet shooting.
If you're like a militant Muslim and you see him walking down the street, do you shoot him? Or do you just be like, what do you get? Fuck you, what
do
you, Rusty.
What do you get if you shoot him? Is there like a
72 virgins in heaven?
But I mean, that's the only reward, right? But I thought you had to be
a pretty nice reward.
But I thought you had to be a virgin to get.
I mean, they're all guys, but still, you get 72 virgins.
Didn't you have to be a virgin to get the 72 virgins?
Oh, do you have to be a virgin too? Oh, I didn't know that.
I don't know. I'm
that would be like the stickler of the rule, where you'd be like, oh, I didn't know
Did
that.
Did you say stickle of fluoride?
Speckle of fluoride. Brian Cranston. If Brian properly cut out all the Walking Dead, Breaking Bad information, then that Brian Cranston line won't make any sense.
But the Brian Cranston should stay in because it's Seinfeld. It doesn't count because it's not Breaking Bad, right?
Seinfeld,
it's pre-Breaking Bad. And he's in more than one episode.
Yeah, Tim Watley.
Remember when he went to his party?
The Thanksgiving party with the parade.
Yeah, and Mr. Pitt ended up being, remember Elaine won the contest for him
underdog? Was it underdog?
I can't remember who he was.
But then something fell out the window and popped a balloon, right?
Oh, it was Woody Woodpecker. Ha 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 ha.
Is that the party that Jerry's not actually invited to and he just goes anyway?
He said, Jerry, why did you
Yeah, right.
Or did he say, Jerry, why did you
show? Why'd you show up? See, this should be the podcast. I was randomly talking about other shows. Just I don't even know how many
How many shows we can name in an hour and a half?
You should have a whiteboard up and just like...
Just keep going there. See what, like, because each one, like, you know,
what
you
do you think
you start talking Seinfeld, then you're like, oh, that makes you think of this character, then you think of that a different show that person was on, and it goes doom, doom, doom.
You know who's in Seinfeld? Skyler is one of Jerry's girls,
yes.
Among many, many other girls.
What was she, though? Do you remember what one she was?
I don't remember what she was.
She, I was just thinking of the girl that was opening.
Was she Manhands?
Remember the naked lady? She was opening the jar.
She was definitely not
her,
the
right?
Bad naked. No, she was not that girl. Oh, man. What was she?
Cartwright. She yelled Cartwright. I yelled Cartwright. She yelled curse word. I hang up.
So he said Cartwright? Who's Cartwright?
I'm Cartwright. There's a part in that episode. When George goes to use the payphone, first of all, he goes to use the payphone.
And the woman grabs it.
Somebody else grabs it. But no, before that, a guy's on it. And then he goes over to Jerry and he says to Jerry, he said, you got my back if something goes down here? And Jerry's like, what the hell? He's ready to rumble with this guy.
Did you know that the guy that played Elaine's dad, Lawrence Tierney, is that his name?
I know who you're talking about. He was very difficult to work with.
He was the guy in Reservoir Dogs. He was the main guy in Reservoir Dogs. He was the guy that dug like this. He's like, you're Mr. White, you're Mr. Pink. And apparently, they couldn't work with him. So he never got asked back to be on.
That's why he was only in that one episode with Jerry's jacket. He made him turn it inside out, remember?
Yeah, we had a funny boy in Korea. Got his brains blown out all over.
Master of the house.
Yeah, master of the house. Which, I got to be honest, I remember watching that Seinfeld episode 10 years, at least 10 years, before I ever saw Les Mis.
I still have never seen
and
Les Mis.
I remember when I saw Les Mis and sat there suffering through it, I was like,
hope
this,
I just you can't wait I'm to hear
like,
that song.
I didn't even remember that at the time. I remember just sitting there watching this fucking play, being like, why does anybody like this? This is fucking terrible. And then Master of the House got played. I'm like, oh,
I know
Master of the House. I'm like, I know George sang this. I love this song. All I knew is that 3-second clip where George got Master of the House. I'm like, I know that song. Yeah, I love it. But that was
and
it.
And you're like, I hope they sing that one again in the show.
Oh, man.
I've never seen Les Mis. You?
No. My daughters watch it continuously.
It is fucking terrible. And I'm not an anti-play guy. Like, I've seen some musicals that I like a lot.
I like a nice musical.
West Side Story, yeah. Grease, Book of Mormon, love them. I'd watch them. I watched West Side Story like last year. It was on.
There's a Steven Spielberg.
I don't know how much I'm excited about that one. But, yeah. I mean, I watched West Side Story last year. It doesn't get more singy and dancier than West Side Story. And I love that movie. Les Mis is a big steaming pile of shit. I'll fight anybody on that. Les Mis and The Wire. Fucking come fight me.
All right, we don't have to throw The Wire in here. I mean, I just said I liked it. Yeah. I mean, I know a lot of people that do like The Wire.
I know. It was huge. That's my old hang. I'm with Brian. Like, cop procedural things, I just don't care. I don't care. Because you know it's just going to be like, the cops are probably bad. The good guys, the drug dealers you're going to root for. I'm like, all right, I've done this before. But I haven't, actually, because I never watched those shows.
Yeah, but not
Hill Street Blues.
Hill Street Blues, we've got those Hill Street Blues. Hill Street Blues, we've got those Hill Street Blues.
Is that from something?
Yeah, it is.
I don't know what that's
on,
from.
Family Guy. Lois and her dad are at the piano, and they sing a song, and he said, let's do another one. Let's do another one. And she's like, what's funny? He's like, let's do the theme to Hill Street Blues. And she's like, there's no words. And he's like, yes, there is. And he's like, Hill Street Blues.
Those are the words?
Hill Street Blues. You've got those Hill Street Blues.
I do remember the tune, the piano, the doon, 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 doon. Yeah, I never watched that. I never liked cop shows.
I told you I wanted to start doing, like, Taxi, I saw was on Hulu. So I was like, oh, let me just watch this for fun.
Is that a cop show?
No, Taxi.
I know, I'm kidding.
But all right, so, but like
cop shows.
I looked at the first season and it went like episode one, then it went episode four. I was like, it was like skipping episodes. Oh. I was like, why are certain episodes on there? Like, and you have all seasons, but then you skip some episodes. And I looked on IMDb; those episodes exist.
they didn't just number them incorrectly.
Like, yeah, so it's like, why? Is it because they didn't get the rights to maybe that episode because of the song or something? Maybe. I don't know.
Like all those Beavis and Butthead episodes, they had to like remove all the videos and songs and stuff like that.
I had the State.
Oh, they do that too?
I watched that on Paramount Plus, and I had the DVDs, and they had to change the music because there was like, it was MTV, so they had all the rights to music on there so they could play that.
Why is that? That's so weird.
I guess because the artist doesn't get anything for it. I guess they have to get something for it. I don't know the way
they pay them something for it.
I guess it's difficult.
But they don't have to pay MTV for it?
I think it's happened with WKRP in Cincinnati because they had a lot of music on there. And the Wonder Years. The Wonder Years had a lot of original music on there.
That's like when you watch those shitty documentaries where it's not like rockumentaries, where it's not like sanctioned by the band.
Oh, yeah.
And they never actually play the band's music. It's always like kind of. It's off key, just like...
You could tell, like, oh, that's that song,
but it's not even that song. Yeah. It's a karaoke,
it's an elevator version.
Yeah,
of it. Yeah.
And you're like, oh, they guess they didn't get the rights to that. That's why I was kind of excited about the Grateful Dead movie.
Yeah, because they got the rights.
Because all those guys are producers in it, so it should be good. But then Jonah Hill was.
They
in
got
it,
the rights
so
to the music.
I said, fuck Jonah Hill.
I don't know. He looks like he could possibly.
I'm not
be
a big
good
fan.
Jerry.
I've never been a big fan of any of those kinds of movies. Like, I know everybody sucks Bohemian Rhapsody's dick, but like, I saw it once. It was kind of like
I liked it.
All right, it's fine.
It
but
was good one time. That's all I needed to.
It's
see.
Like
yeah.
it's like a really long music video. That's all it is. Just play the hits. You know, I want to see you guys create. We Will Rock You. Okay, we're gonna stand in the studio and be like, hey, how about if we went boom, 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 boom. Like, because that's how that song got created.
That was annoying. I did like how they had Michael Myers in. As,
that was fun.
That was funny. You know, like a little tip of the hat.
Yeah, and saying that there was no way that anybody would be in a car jamming out to Bohemian Rhapsody when he did that really exact funny. Thing. And Littlefinger was in that, too. He was one of those studio execs.
Yeah, yeah, but Bohemian Rhapsody, one time is good for that.
Can I be honest? I don't even want to talk about Love Boat.
I know you don't.
I mean, like, I don't care. I knew this was going to be a problem. We haven't talked in months. But I need another drink. You got, like, fucking 20 pages of notes.
But I could talk through this quicker. I don't even have to look at my notes. If you want to just play this, we'll play it right through. We could do that. I mean.
Do you want to take a break now?
Yeah, I got to take a break.
And then we'll come back and then we'll do Love Boat.
We'll motor through.
There is a lot of editing that needs to be done.
How about if we start going off, I'll do a.
There's a part of me that almost doesn't want him to edit this. it's so terrible.
We need to hear the raw version of it, definitely.
Who cares? He won't fucking edit it anyway.
Do you know how long this is going to take to edit?
I feel like I should
But the thing is, sometimes I'm like, yeah, minute 48, I said blah, 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 let's get that out of there. And you're like, okay.
I feel the only thing that would make him edit it as if I just scream the N-word after any time I said something. Is, oh, that's got to come out now.
And now you know he's leaving that in, you saying that.
But I didn't say the N-word. I know, but you're... I said the N-word.
You're insinuating saying it now.
Well, I'm saying the only way he would edit it out is if I said that word. I won't say that word, but if I really wanted something to be taken out, when I'm talking about pedophilia or something like that, and I'm like, eh, I don't feel good about this conversation. Or what was I talking about a couple weeks ago? The circumcision one. I was like, I specifically said, I'm like, dude, I'm like, I don't feel comfortable about it. And you just left it fucking in. And I even screamed. I'm like, don't leave this in. And you left me screaming, don't leave this in.
That was
N-word.
But that whole circumcision thing was great.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
I think the problem with this episode is the guest stars. We don't know
them. Very weak. I mean, and it's really Marion Ross. She's it.
Yeah.
And she's in the worst possible role in this whole show.
Even Mrs. Cotter doesn't give you much.
She doesn't rank. She would be good as like a fourth star. Like, oh, Mrs. Cotter, what's she's doing? She's hot here. She's 25
like,
or whatever.
Like when we had like a young Joanna Kearns on there, that was different.
And she was like a Jane Curtin bit was, player in that one. I am so low on the share. I think my mic started up here. I am now down here. I'm like, just like,
you're sliding off
just
your
like,
chair.
Keep bringing the mic down.
Your ass isn't even on the chair.
His sciatica is going to be bothering me.
I'll hit pause now, and then we can take our break.
All right.
Can we go back a little bit here?
I don't know how to rewind.
Are we even here? I mean,
we did get here. This was Dr. Mesquite shooting right before this,
I
think.
I almost feel like we got to go back to the beginning just because, like, who even knows what's going on? Okay.
No,
As soon as the scene ends. I always like the nighttime scenes of the boat like that.
I do like that. And I like when the boat's lit up like that, yeah. Here we had Courtney behind the bar, which he knew was just going to be a mistake from the beginning.
And he just automatically just smashes the whole thing of, is that toothpicks or something like that?
Like the stirrers or whatever.
It's just so funny how, I mean, Isaac's not a short guy, but.
And this was
he's standing next to him. He towers over him. It's crazy.
When he pours this guy a drink, he pours it like.
He just
really
keeps pouring.
It's just, and it's,
he pours all the way to the top.
He starts pouring
and
it
he
back,
pours
into,
back
the
into the
bottle,
bottle,
spilling it, which is just ridiculous. And then he does what Isaac did about trying to get this guy to talk about his problems.
And it's so funny. This guy's like a glorified extra. He's not one of the cast members.
He got a couple lines here.
Yeah, he's in it for a couple of minutes. But it's so funny how
he didn't make the credits. Yeah, and there was three people on IMDb that I didn't look into. I was like, fuck
there's
it.
One guy on the deck that they talk to for a second who's got some kind of credit as a comedian or something like that I guess we'll get to. But and it's with, what's his name, Courtney?
L. Courtney.
Courtney. L. L. Courtney. L. Courtney. Is it L? Like the letter
the
L?
The letter L, period. Courtney. Tells us what his name is because they call him Courtney.
I'm going to guess Lionel. All right, so now... Mrs. Cunningham and her sister come into the bar.
Yep, and this is where Mrs. Cunningham is still trying to talk her into like seeing Clark.
Yeah, hook up. Why aren't you hooking up?
Yeah, and Pat Crowley here, Noreen, she had just won the jackpot, two jackpots.
Two jackpots.
$52.75.
Good for her. This episode.
I should have asked you how much. I'm sorry.
I wouldn't have guessed that. I wouldn't have guessed, but.
But you were
guessing. I would have guessed wrong. When
but
I said,
you
would have guessed.
20 cents.
This episode had a lot of gambling. I mean, I had one scene. We've talked about that in the past about they never, ever show the casinos.
We don't see much gambling
casinos. But there's a whole roulette scene in this,
17,
which was really nice.
Right? 17
wins.
Black.
I wouldn't know 17 was... Is it black?
That's
it
what I only knew because it won, yeah. Here, Clark tries to get in on the conversation and basically telling Noreen, basically saying he's interested in her. You know, basically
he's laying
right
it
out.
On very thick.
Yeah.
And... I mean, I don't know, man. I am not that comfortable as a hitter. I would never just assume that the woman wants to be hit on, and I wouldn't assume that she's single.
I was just going to say, you have to assume she's with another lady even, too. So it's like, how do you make that? I wouldn't walk up to two girls. I mean,
No.
And that's why I'm on this podcast right now.
Yeah, this is a brave, brazen, bold move right here.
Oh, Jason, he's so funny.
Oh, he's so funny. You want to go out? Oh, no.
Yeah, I got that thing.
I got a thing. So, yeah, so he's macking on the girl. Now, I don't know why Mrs. Cunningham starts, like, bristling at this. There's never
she's a giggling. She's like a little schoolgirl.
But there's
here.
Never a change in her in what's going on here where she should be feeling, why are you talking to this guy? Or now that you're spending time with them later on.
I mean, it's obvious we obviously know she's jealous of it. Like,
what are they drinking?
She had an orangeade and she had scotch.
Scotch. Yeah. Straight up, right?
Just, no, orangeade. What's the liquor in that? Is there?
I think it's just like lemonade.
Orangeade is a fucking good drink.
But it's like non-alcoholic,
high C
right?
orange?
Yeah,
or
it's just non-alcoholic, right?
Halo. That's what I was wondering. Is there any alcohol in an orangeade?
I don't believe so.
But I didn't know if there was or not, yeah.
That sounds like a 70s drink.
Here we had Julie handing out pillows.
When L. Courtney is walking with Julie, it is...
That's at least a
distracting
foot.
Distracting how much taller than
over a foot, right?
Over a foot. She's not 5'7". She's probably like 5'4" or something like that, so...
And I don't think she's really wearing heels. She's wearing like a more
flats
of a flat shoe.
Like
yeah.
that. She's not wearing heels.
She offers the pillow here to this guy, and this guy good is line here. Major.
Like, this is the guy that's got an IMDb credit.
Oh, is this him? Yeah.
He's
okay.
Some comedian. I mean, I looked him up, but...
I should have... is that the Monty Grady guy that's in like a 500 different things, remember?
No, I looked him up. He didn't do a lot, but he was a stand-up in the 50s or something like that. So
he had the line where, what if I told you my name was Jack Daniels?
Because she said something about
she was
going
to go back to her bedroom and have bourbon. Yeah.
Good for her. She said bourbon. That's my
new
drink.
She's also
like,
a bourbon drinker now, too.
And she said, what about an old granddad? He said, my name is Jack Daniels.
She said, you remind me more of old granddad, right. Which is good. And then L. Courtney uses the old granddad line here, too.
Well, he physically assaults... a guest by
that guy is totally asleep
and he just shoves the pillow under him. This is not being clumsy or awkward. This is being
that's a felon. That's like you want to start something. Like, this guy's starting something with me, right? Oh, you hit Chucky.
Oh, sorry, Chuck. Yeah, this is and he starts yelling at him. He's like, you're like my old granddad or something like
that. Yeah, Julie just goes like this. She just shakes her head.
Now, he's not obviously qualified to be an admiral of a ship.
It's a nice pool scene.
He's not qualified to be like a greeter at Walmart, this guy. He is a terrible person.
Oh, yeah.
And by that, I mean a terrible person. I don't know what happened to my voice there. It must be the bourbon and beer.
Here's where
bourbon.
Bill sits down with Stephanie and just she was like about to leave, but he stays and he orders two champagne cocktails.
Yeah, I'm not sure what a champagne cocktail is. Is it just champagne?
It looks like just champagne, and it's also 10 a.m. So Isaac.
Well, he says like that's a good eye opener.
Yeah, rather than coffee. Yeah. Yep. And she says she doesn't really want to have a drink unless they were introduced. So he tells Isaac who
they
he
do
is.
The old
Bill
and Stephanie.
He says he's
83 Stephanie.
Years old.
I don't know, man. Drinking that early. I listen, as a bona fide alcoholic, drinking that early is tough, man. You're drinking at 10 o'clock in the morning. You are sleeping by 2.
Just,
On the cruise, every morning, we would see people walking around with like the Coors Light, the aluminum cans.
It's too early, man.
And we went to this thing. It was like 8:30 in the morning, and there's everybody in there has them. And then we went to get water, and that's what they're serving. So I thought it was just a ship full of old alcoholics.
They were serving them in the cans,
yeah,
like recycled.
Like the Silver Bullet, you know, the Coors Light.
Yeah, yeah, the 16-ounce like bottles.
Water on it, you know.
Interesting. I like that.
That's not bad. It's, yeah, maybe that's a post-COVID
thing. I don't
know
if we talked about this in our podcast, but Brian just went on a cruise. Just cruise.
We have the hats to prove it. The sombreros to prove it.
The sombreros to prove it. You went to Mexico. Did we talk about that in the context of this podcast?
I think you might have mentioned that he went to... We
Cozumel.
Talked about him going to the east side of...
Cozumel and Belize. Okay,
Eastern
yeah.
Mexico, so we did... Yeah.
That was like 17 hours ago. So I forget what we talked about earlier.
But that might have been before we even started, too.
Maybe. I just wanted to point that out that Brian is now a seasoned vet. Not that he wasn't before, but...
You've been on multiple cruises, so it's not like you're...
No, yeah, this is the first cruise back after COVID, though.
Yeah. Was it weird?
It was a little weird.
Was anybody wearing masks?
All of Belize.
like the
it's like
the
a
town?
Fine of $500 if you don't wear.
So
a mask.
When you got off the boat, you had to wear a mask in Belize.
We had to put our masks on as we got on the tender, and then we tendered into the city, and everybody in the city.
Are they vigilant with their masks? Like you see, like if you could be walking through town and there's random people telling you to put it on or keep it on, like not wear like a chin diaper.
I never. There were a few people who were like had it down, but for the most part, I saw people driving alone in their cars and had their masks
on.
I see those people now.
I want to hit them.
Then I look in the back to think maybe they're like an Uber or a Lyft or something like that. And then you see it's just them, and I'm like,
our tour guide.
Did he just forget to take it off?
Broke his mask while he was driving us, and he started getting really nervous because he was looking around for police and stuff, and we gave him two extra masks.
Holy, that's scary. Yeah, because he's probably like, yeah, they're gonna pull me over and put me in. Prison.
Yeah.
Well, Brian and I are going on a cruise in, where are we going? March?
March.
It better be, COVID better be done by that. And I think we said this 6 months ago, and I thought it was going to be done by now, and here we are 6 months later.
I know,
later.
But we also talked about doing that shroom cast.
Oh my God, I want to do that still.
I was just at that place where I buy stuff, and I saw that there's shrooms there.
Just buy them, man. How much are they?
I think 40.
For a personal or for enough for three?
I don't know. That's the thing. I mean, how much do we need for? I think 40 might be enough.
I don't even know.
Like, might be enough for one thing. I don't know. I haven't done shrooms in a while.
You want to do it?
I'll have to ask my cardiologist.
Well, I was going to say, you can't test positive for that to fail a government drug test, right?
I don't know.
I don't think that's something that would show up, right?
It would be out of your system in a couple of
like,
days.
Sir, did you eat some fungi?
I'll have to cut this.
Yeah, good.
Good, that's good.
I didn't say your last name.
You just said he had a government job.
Although he makes all his... Oh, yeah. He's the only Brian working in the government.
There's not a lot of Brians, especially the way he spells it.
Him? He spells it regular.
Yeah, so I'm saying the other ones are B-R-Y, like Brian Cranston.
And our
the
friend,
wrong way.
Our friend Mac is a B-R-Y.
The wrong way.
Just like I think J-A-Y is the wrong way for Jason.
No one spells it like that.
I went to school with a kid who spelled it like that.
Those are like cartoon characters and people on Game of Thrones. They throw a Y in there to make it look all cool.
Well, I'm just telling you, I went to school with a kid that had it. And then I went to school with a Jason that had an E-N. J-A-S-E-N.
Ugh.
And then...
I have a follow-up question on that,
I was
going to
go into my middle name. I don't want to do middle names on here. That's getting too personal. Cut this out, too. Go ahead. What did you want to say?
Nothing. I think we were really on a roll there, and then I mentioned Brian's cruise, and now we got off again.
So. Oh, wait a second. I'm supposed to.
Yeah, he's supposed to get us back on track.
We went off track.
Elsa Lanchester joining the cast. Bride of Frankenstein.
Oh. Who? Elsa
Lanchester? Elsa Lanchester, yeah. That's her. She is right there.
Yeah, I know her face. I wouldn't know her name.
So we get Bill hitting on Stephanie pretty hard here. She mentions that she was in the Super Bowl.
They are both hitting on each other with their ridiculous stories of Super Bowl injuries and Lithuanian
royalty.
And all that.
I was really hoping a Lithuanian royalty would have been true. Like, that's really what she would have been. That would have been cool. And she said, I'm a Lithuanian cop. I can't.
Or, like, I'll launder this through the Lithuanian embassy and make it all clean.
Yeah.
That would have been fun.
Oh, man, we have a spinoff for this show.
Oh, my God.
If we went to executives right now, we're like, we got a spinoff idea. They're like, oh, what's it spinning off from what? We're like, season one, episode 18 of The Love Boat.
We're taking Mrs. Cotter and this guy.
Yeah.
What's his name?
They're like, I know his name is Bill in the episode.
Bill.
Is that Frank Converse? Frank Converse, right?
Converse sneakers, yeah.
And, I was like, the only one still alive, I said, and that's Frank Converse still alive. I don't know. So we're going to have to cast somebody in the other role. Who do you think we should get?
Can we, like, deep fake her face onto, like, another actress's body, Grand Moff Tarkin style or something like that?
Grand Moff Tarkin was awesome in the original, but...
Well, I'm talking about, like, in Rogue One where he popped
that
up.
That was
again.
Cool. I liked that, too.
I didn't have a problem with it. I like Rogue One a lot. Rogue One, I think, is the best of the... Disney Star Wars movies.
I'll agree with you there. And I'll go on record as saying I enjoyed Solo. I know a lot of people didn't like Solo, but I enjoyed Solo.
I liked Solo. I thought the cramming of every single thing in his life, like his last name and his gun.
Sometimes I think they're going too far with the fan. Like,
we do not
we
need
get
to
Easter
know
eggs.
Everything.
We get Easter eggs, but don't make the Easter eggs that easy.
It's not an Easter egg when it's just spelled out for you like that. But I like Solo. I didn't hate Solo. I hated
7, 8, 9.
I thought Force Awakens was really good.
I think
good.
8 was the worst out of those.
Oh, no, 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 no. Rise of Skywalker is a gigantic piece of shit. It's amazing.
I agree with
it
you on that,
amazing.
But 8
like,
is also bad.
It's amazing watch eight. How people... Oh, I hate 8 also, but...
Not the hateful 8. We like
when,
that.
When people talk about like bad Star Wars movies, they'll talk about like Phantom Menace. Phantom Menace is a fucking Academy Award movie compared to Rise of Skywalker.
Agree.
I mean, Rise of Skywalker is I'll never watch that again. I will never, ever watch that again.
All right, you got us on track there. That was good.
I did want you to get that
finish
out.
My
to get too far going off there, yeah. All right, so what we got they introduced themselves, and like you said, they had the crazy talk about
Lithuania and Super Bowls and
yeah.
What's he say he is? Because she hurt her arm in the Super Bowl, and she says she's a Lithuanian princess.
She was a Lithuanian royalty.
What's he?
Why can I not find where I had these notes? This is really bothering me. I lost my. Introduces himself.
Your
Maureen
train of thought still boarding.
What's your? No, I guess I'm on to the Clark Tyler stuff. Yeah.
Who the fuck is Clark Tyler?
That's Clark Tyler, the guy that was talking to Pat Crowley.
I know. She calls him Mr. Tyler later. I'm like, I thought his first name was Tyler. Anyway, so this guy, so she's all hungover from her one glass of scotch the next day. And now Marion Ross is acting like you don't need to go with him. I think Jason wrote his notes.
Oh, he did write, he wrote he was the VP of the biggest brokerage in LA. He told her
right,
who he
which
really
he actually was.
Yeah. So, I'm sorry.
You just wanted to get that part out.
Yeah,
that
was bothering me
that
I missed
down.
It. Then I was like, oh, it's right before this. I was like, mother, father.
Clark Tyler takes Pat something
yeah,
away.
She was talking about her hangover, which I mentioned earlier. She drank scotch. She should not have been hungover like that.
One whole glass, though, Jason. You've probably never drank a whole glass before.
And so she needed aspirin and a long walk. And she's like, how long can a walk be on a boat? Can't walk that far, right? I guess then the next scene was the whole crew comes in to see our buddy L. Are we calling him L? Or are we calling him Courtney? What are we calling him? L Courtney?
L Courtney Cox.
They're coming to see L. They're coming to see L Courtney, and he starts talking about how he doesn't like the sea.
He's not a seaman.
He's not into seamen, no.
No, he's not into seamen.
He talks about what he wants to do. Do you remember what he wants to be? What he wants to do instead of going to sea?
Of course I do. I mean, I saw the rest of the episode.
I wanted you to say it. I just wanted to
He wants to be a ballet dancer.
I was just leading the end.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he wants to be a ballet dancer.
And,
sorry, thank you for
He says you're going to laugh at me if I tell you. And when he pulls out his, they called them pantyhose first.
Yes, leotard.
And they thought it was little boys' pantyhose, which I thought was weird that they
never begrudge a person for wanting to be a ballet dancer, but there is no graceful way that a 6'10" guy can dance around.
And
this guy is a big clod.
And he will prove that later
and
on.
He will, you know, the fact that he wants to be the one thing that he cannot be.
It was so
he has
bad.
A better chance. He has
almost,
a better chance of being an astronaut.
It was almost
like, there's
the
no
point,
way he can be a ballet
It was
dancer.
Almost to the point where like he's like, you know, you're hanging out and they're like, the one person just acts weird. That's what it seemed like. And that's what, like, oh, he's drunk. And that's what Stubing said. He probably tied one on the night before.
Right.
And I'm sorry, I'm going
off. I think they
were
trying to go with the, like, it's effeminate kind of thing. But it's not effeminate. He is a big, gawky guy. He has no ballet in him. He's not a dancer.
They mentioned Nureyev, you know. And so I looked up who Rudolf Nureyev was.
Oh, yeah. He was the premier of Russia after Brezhnev.
He was a Soviet-born ballet dancer and choreographer. They said he was the greatest of his generation. He died 1993 of AIDS at 54.
I'm surprised they didn't go with who's the other famous Russian dancer?
Oh, Baryshnikov?
Baryshnikov. I'm surprised they didn't go with him because everybody would have known him unless he wasn't around in 1978. Maybe he was later than that.
Or was that? I guess, yeah, one was before the other, maybe.
I don't know. Burstikoff, I would have known if they said his name. I'm like, oh, yeah, the dancer guy. But
Nureyev sounded familiar, and I was just like, let me just look this up. But
I would have thought every other Russian's named Nureyev. Does everybody's name have to end in
Nureyev?
Are
you allowed to say that?
Like, don't they have other letters that end words besides Ev?
They have their own weird alphabet. Yeah,
backwards R's and upside down Q's and shit
they
like that.
They do a lot of like umlauts too, right?
I don't think I think that's more like German.
Or what's the double dot?
That's umlaut. That's, like over the like no, the Molly Crew and stuff like that.
There's the one that has the like the curve over the letters.
Do like the C's that like kind of like bend more. I don't know what that is.
And then I think there's a C, and then there's like something that dips below the C or something.
Stupid old looks everybody like, else's
looks like
letters.
The C has balls.
Yes. Like Spanish has like double L's and
the R's,
the tildes on the little squiggly lines on top of the N's and stuff like that.
I have to make an
Enye.
We speak Spanish, Brian.
I took 15 years of it in school, and
let me
I don't
tell
know
you,
any of it.
The jobs I've had over the years, I've met a lot of Spanish-speaking people, and you pick up a lot. Like, you really do.
I work with Spanish-speaking people every day, and I know nothing. And they look at me like I know nothing.
I feel like you pick up a lot. Like, you don't realize it.
Pendejo.
There you go. Yeah, that one, that Andy probably gets called that a lot.
I look at everybody just like, can we speak English here? This is America. Can we speak American?
Now that you might want to cut out.
Oh, no, I stand by that. Stand by it. Everybody speak American.
Is that the sounds you're making so Brian knows where to cut and edit?
No, I'm fine with that statement.
Here's our, we got a little gambling action here.
This guy looks like the dealer, the roulette wheel spinner. I know we call him a dealer, even though he's not dealing cards.
I hate that they call him dealer.
Yeah, so the dealer roulette here is a, he looks like Peter Falk, Columbo. Like when he first
just
popped
one more thing.
In, which is one more thing. When he first popped in, I was like, did they get Peter Falk to play the dealer just on
do you,
a
do you know
cameo?
Why they went with 17?
Because that was her birthday.
Yeah, December 17th.
But he played 25 first at Lost because he said that's how old she was. But she said thanks. Like that's not how old she was.
Yeah, I forget what number came out when he played 25.
Oh, I don't know. But they went on 17.
28.
Wait.
Yeah, it was close, right?
Wait,
it was close to what
it was on. 24. And 26 came out.
Oh,
that's what it was.
That's we were all wrong.
Yeah, awesome. I did write it down. I didn't realize it. Then they say, let's celebrate. And she says, let's do the number one thing
the
to
oldest
celebrate.
Thing, the oldest thing to celebrate thing in the books. So everybody's thinking like they're going knocking boots.
Yeah, they decide. She says, dancing.
And he's like, oh, but my boner's way up here by my chin.
I'm tucking it into my underwear.
And they've known each other for
the band.
6 hours? I don't know.
And these two say I love you very quickly,
yeah,
I thought.
They are in love, which is great. That's fine. I'm not saying you can't fall in
this
love in
love
a day.
Boat,
but...
And this is a quick cruise because they leave on Friday and they're coming back on a Monday holiday.
That's correct. They come back on holiday. Is it
the bank
Labor Day or something like that? Do we know what holiday this is?
Like, I mean, the episode aired in, was that March of 78, I think I said?
Yeah, there's no March holiday, is there? St. Patrick's Day is not a day off.
Let's see what date was that.
I think you said February. February 4th?
Yeah, February 4th, 78.
Is it President's Day, maybe?
That doesn't have to be further into February,
right? Yeah.
It's usually after Valentine's Day. You got President's Day, Martin Luther King.
Martin Luther King's like January, and I'm sure in 1978 they weren't celebrating that yet.
This is something that happens too often in the Love Boat.
We got the...
Somebody sees somebody else doing something that they were just... that their whole story is about. That happens so much.
But this is the way that they tie all the stories together. Marion Ross just so happens to be standing...
What was it last episode or two episodes ago? Somebody was... It was Robert Urich, I think. He was smoking a cigar watching somebody.
Oh, my God. He was in the dark shadows. Yeah. And like,
might have been in that same seat. Here. It was under this... might have been under the steps like
and
that.
And who would... Like, there's no one on deck at this time. Why are you sitting under the steps?
She's hiding,
so people's
obviously.
Dirty ass shoes are like knocking dirt on you as
you're
they're walking
up dresses as they walk by,
or that. Yeah, no one's picking that seat. That is the seat you get when you're like, ah, shit.
There's
only
one
seat.
There's only one table left. I'm gonna grab it.
I'm taking the seat that no one's taken, but
nobody's sitting here, right? No. But that just seems to happen every episode.
Well, it's a transition kind of
thing. But that might
be
something
they're
to call out.
They're going from the one story to the other
story.
This
could be something that we pick up on.
Yeah,
that.
It doesn't happen that often, though, but it happens
you
like
watch,
once.
Brian, it's going to happen.
No, I think it happens like once an episode where they're transitioning
that's
from
one. That's too often, I think, if it's once an episode.
All right, they do one kind of confetti throw an episode, so I guess
but that's a
bon
voyage scene, and Brian confirmed that that happens.
I thought you confirmed that happens.
No, I wasn't on the boat.
In an actual boat.
Yeah, he confirmed what.
There were people on the shore.
Yeah.
There were like six people riding bikes. They weren't even paying
But he proved to me that
boat.
There were some people there. Because remember I said, what are they waving to? Who are they waving to?
There was a little girl in a parking lot, too. She sounded like she was like in the room next door, just yelling from the shore. And like everybody in the balconies was waving to her.
That's kind of cool. I remember when Michelle and I went on a cruise a million years ago to Bermuda.
Ooh, I want to take it.
And when we were leaving Bermuda, there's a lot of like little tiny islands, like right there, like right around the port. And there were people just like in their house, like waving to the boat as we went by. I'm like, is this their day? Do they do this every day? They just wave to every boat that leaves
like,
Bermuda.
Hey, come on, let's go outside.
Hey, we know the Caribbean
like,
boat.
Are you talking about islands that are like so small that there's only like one house and nothing else on it?
There's
like,
a million of them, like right outside. Is that Bermuda?
Do they have to leave the island to go to work? They're like, you taking the rowboat today?
I guess they boat to town.
Or do they have a helicopter?
No, not that big even. Not big enough for that. Like tiny little islands.
That's crazy, right? Like, do you think maybe they just, like, that's their job? Like, they get hired, you have to be in this house and wave to people going by? Like, that might not even be, like, where they live.
Could be.
Might just be something like, so it's just something like, passengers, like you say, like, did you see that? There's people over there. Should we rescue them?
It's like a Walmart greeter, but for Bermuda.
It was like that. They're like, hey, see ya.
I just think the way they make the bon voyage seem, it's like thousands of people are just like welcoming in a ship from
it's
where.
It's like their job
it's
to
like
go
a world,
say goodbye to
war,
their boat.
A World War II ship's coming home, and these kids are coming off the boat for the first time. That's what the bon voyage looks like. I'm sorry.
It does look like that scene that you see at the end of World War II where they're all celebrating in Times Square and the nurse is getting kissed by the soldier and stuff like that. It's a ticker tape parade for a fucking cruise ship leaving out of Los Angeles to go to Mexico.
San Pedro.
It's Los Angeles. Oh, my God. They're leaving.
Also,
again, didn't they leave like yesterday, too?
Also, they were coming back into San Pedro. She's an L.A. cop.
Well, he says it's not her jurisdiction.
I liked her plan. I'm sorry. Jumping ahead.
Brian wasn't playing the little clappy sounds. We were talking about this show, though. We were talking about cruising. We were talking about Star Wars or Breaking Bad.
Mrs. C came running back thinking Noreen was going to be in her cabin. But then she calls up, I guess, the front desk, or whatever.
Give me Mr. Tyler.
And they get,
I was like, is that a way to get another person on the boat?
She gets the cabin room immediately and goes.
Yeah, like immediately. Like they were waiting for her to call with the room number.
And that's when I thought, like,
yeah,
don't
they have to go like this to look it up? They got to go through papers because they don't have it.
I think they're on a switchboard going like, hello? Like pulling all the little cords.
Lay off
out.
The buttons, mister.
And now she sees the do not disturb sign on, which means they are DFT. Wait,
yeah, we got Bill's cabin number here. He was PR338. That was that's Clark. Or no, that's, I'm sorry. That's Bill's cabin. I didn't mean to say that. That was something else. That was in Clark. That's different.
This is Tyler.
Yeah, this is Clark Tyler or
Tyler
yeah.
Clark.
Because
is there a Clark Tyler and a Tyler Clark
no,
on this cruise
Clark,
ship?
It's Clark.
Because that would make sense. Because I am very confused about which one of these guys is which. They should have done that. They're like, Andy will be all fucked up if we call these people by the same name backwards.
So we get Julie at Stubing's cabin here.
And he does not like to be woken
he's
up at 5:30
in the
morning.
He's in his pajamas.
And he's got a monogrammed robe.
I like that.
With
was
a
nice.
Big MS.
You know, Meryl you know, Stubing. You know he's had some ladies in there wearing that. Marion yes. Ross has probably wore that robe.
I've never owned a monogrammed anything in my life.
Never had anything monogrammed, but I remember as a younger kid, maybe in like my early teens, I wore a robe. I used to wear a robe.
I had a Batman robe for a while, but then I realized I didn't really like wearing robes. I'll just walk around in my underwear and t-shirt.
Now I just put sweatpants on. Yeah,
I'll put a hoodie on.
I could see him in like a smoker's jacket.
Oh, for
like,
sure.
Right, you know?
With the and hands like, in the pocket, like the hands like way up
buy,
here.
You buying these hats, like he's like, I already have one. He was like, you
know? Hugh gave me his own.
But so Julie ends up telling Steuben how L. Courtney doesn't want to be
L. Courtney. It sounds like he's a Spanish superhero. L. Courtney.
So she finally gets Steubing. Steubing gets dressed in his shorts and comes out.
He changed that his robe
and
into his
I
shorts.
Didn't think they were going to show it on camera, but they show him doing, I don't know, pliés and whatever ballet moves they're called or whatever.
I don't think any person that does ballet would call these moves anything.
He puts his leg up on the bar.
Full body dry heave right here.
Julie is fully in for this, thinking this guy's really, really wants to be a dancer. And this
I got to be, listen, he threw his leg up on the bar and stretched out. It would take me 15 years to do that, and I would never get my leg off the bar. I'd be like, I'm just here. Burn this ship down around me.
He works his way around the pool, which was just like he could almost. I think he could touch the railing on the second, the second floor. Yeah, he could get up there.
And he falls down there, but he really like Superman. He kind of flew down.
It looked like he was reaching for something to land on, and then he gets up and does more. And he steps on the side of the pool, so you know what's going to happen.
The deck is wet. Yeah, as soon as he got in the pool,
and he went in and. He got his leotards
nonsense.
Wet.
I believe it's only a single leotard.
He gets out of the pool, and Stubing was pretty mean here, a little defiant, like just not defiant, but just like stern. He was very stern with him. Yeah. You know, it was just funny because like he's got a foot
admiral.
And a half. He's got a foot and a half on Merrill
he
here,
does,
doesn't
he's
he?
He's towering over him. Stubing said something about him earlier in the scene where he said. The enemy will be afraid of him as an admiral or something like that because he doesn't think like anybody else, and
yeah,
they'll be confused because of his nautical genius or whatever it was. So it's just so funny that he's built this guy up into his mind to be some kind of, nautical genius, and he's a buffoon.
He basically tells, or Stubing tells him to be at his, be on the bridge at 0800 hours.
Which is late for Stubing. Usually it's 0600. Yeah, maybe.
And you figure it was 0500 when he was talking to him, right? It was a little after 5.
Right.
And then he told him he hates the sea. He hates the ships.
And loves seamen, but not
and
the ship.
He said, and I'm not even sure about you right now.
Yeah.
At Stubing. Nice little dig at Stubing.
It's gotta be tough to be in a family of one specific thing when everybody does the thing, and you don't want to do that.
Yeah,
thing.
And he's the last male Stubing.
He said
he had three
sisters
that were in a commune selling or making candles.
Yeah, and even if they weren't, I mean, I guess technically they could still be Stubings. They
are
Stubings.
They can have babies, right?
But those you would
they
think
changed. I guess they have different last name. Is that why?
Yeah, I mean, like. In the 70s, girls were taking the guys' names and stuff like that. So the babies are going to have.
Yeah, there wouldn't be Stubings that were out on the sea. It'd be like, hey, I'm a Stubing.
But one of those
I'm related,
sisters could have
been. They're 23 and me.
One of those sisters could have become a captain of a ship, right?
What is it?
23
and
me.
23
and
me.
How many chromosomes you got? I think you got
one. I said 32.
Yeah. I think you got more. I think you got extra chromosomes.
That's why I'm having my forehead. Cut
like
that out.
It's like a five head.
Cut that out. Cut it out.
So these two have slept together.
You sound like Dave Coulier now.
These two are in love. This is Stephanie and Bill.
And this is where he mentions, Stephanie and Bill. He mentions he's getting off at Mazatlan.
And flying to Rio.
Mazatlan.
And he said, we'll get a noon flight. We'll go to Rio.
So I find it funny how,
she says she has two books checked out at the library.
Well, she's making jokes about why she can't
but
go.
No,
but
she's really serious, right?
I always find it funny when people use the cruise ship as a destination to someplace else. Like his main objective is to get to Rio. He's got $1 million in hundreds, $10,000 bills, and he wants to get to Rio, but he's taking a luxury slow-moving cruise ship to Mexico.
But do you think since he leaves early from the cruise, doesn't go all the way through with the cruise, leaving at Mazatlan, that's his way of maybe trying to lose that paper trail of him?
I guess you would figure if you're flying out of L.A. to Rio, they probably, scan your bags. Maybe he's thinking Mexico security is not as tight in the 70s. He could just walk through with a big case of $100 bills. He really should have like converted that into something more manageable.
And like I told you, it should be wrapped, like rubber banded somehow.
It should be something. So now he opens it up. He is so in love with this girl after 12 hours.
It's their first night together, yeah.
Yeah, so they've woken up together. They met yesterday, and now he shows her all the hundreds, and he's like, that's right, I am a criminal. And she says, I am a cop.
She's like, did you embezzle it?
And he's like,
sort of, I stole it. But yeah, he's like really in love with her too. Like where
they are in love. They've said they love each other already.
And she even said it like, she's like, I love you. Like it was kind of like, what am I doing? She didn't know what she was doing.
But now she pulls out her badge.
She's like, an LA cop, right?
I am a cop. This would have been a great sequel show.
Oh, like a spinoff?
She's the LA cop. He's the hustler.
And he gets out. He does a couple years for...
I think like her protecting him. Like he kept a million.
Trouble, you think?
Yeah, yeah. Like she's a dirty cop.
Oh, I would like that then. Yeah, that would be good.
And she's protecting him. He's got the millions. And they're always like, so, Stephanie,
she's always
I see
like,
you driving that Lamborghini to work today.
And they're like,
your cop salary in 1970, it's like $23,000 a year. Like, how do you expect
I thought it was 2 pounds of cocaine that we brought in. Now it's 1.5 pounds.
Oh, yeah, and he's using that millions to like launder other drug money. Yes.
Do we take this to Netflix?
I like this idea. But we got to set it in the 70s, and it takes place on a love boat or on a love boat type boat where they're...
If we can intertwine it where it does intersect with the real love boat, I think that would be...
But I think like somehow they are using the boat to launder the money. And then you see the same crew people all the time, like the Isaac and the Julie.
Wait,
of
does
this.
Bill get a job?
They're
on
like,
the, Bill gets a
hey,
job.
Hey, you
on
guys
the...
are back on this cruise ship again. They're like, yeah. And here, can you turn this into clean pesos for us or whatever?
Yeah, you figure like he's gonna have a bank account in Mazatov and one in like Cabo San Lucas. But these, like you said, these two are in love, and they're thinking like he's trying to talk her into like going to Rio still.
Yep. And he says, listen, I give up. You do what you have to do.
He's like saying, so was last night. They get back in the bed, which I think is weird, right?
You know what I also want to say is weird? And I know it's a TV show, but like guys wearing pajama pants.
I think we mentioned that in the previous episode.
I don't get it, man.
I never, it's not comfortable, especially even with the shirt.
With
like
a big
button shirt.
Bow tie on the front like you're tying something?
The big button shirts, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. The Mike Brady shirts. I don't know.
There's the $1 million
dump.
Oh,
so you do the, I was going to say Desperate Housewives. No, was it? Indecent Proposal.
Indecent Proposal, and which is funny because she says, is this a proposition or a proposal? She asks that before.
So she
before
is like.
She finds out. Do you think she was really injured? Is that why she had the cast? Or?
I guess so. It would have been fun if they found out why she had the cast on her arm. She's a cop.
They did say.
She said she got it apprehending
chasing a perp,
somebody.
Yeah. Said she broke her arm chasing a purse snatcher.
I wonder if her arm was really broken and they just had to write that into the script, I wonder.
Oh, yeah.
Couldn't they have just got another person to play that?
Well, no, that's...
Miss Cotter?
Yeah, they needed Julia. I have to go back and see if she's a... There's ever a time when she was like in a photo, like, oh my God, she has a cast on. Like,
now, when did Mrs. Cotter, when did Welcome Back Cotter air?
I don't know. This is 78. That might have just ended, right. Or because I think that ended in the 70s.
She was like that young as his wife.
He wasn't that old either, though. I think he was only like 30.
Oh, man.
Because John Travolta was like only a couple years younger than
say, John Travolta was like 37. Gabe Kaplan,
I saw something the other
teacher.
Day. John Travolta and Tommy Lee are like really good friends.
Motley Crue, Tommy Lee?
Yeah.
Really?
They're really good friends. They like call each other and talk
like
all the
they
time.
Become, like, how'd they become friends?
I don't know if they're neighbors.
I want
or
that documentary.
Like that.
The John Travolta, Tommy Lee documentary.
Like how they first met. And yeah, that's interesting.
Like, is he coming over and say, hey, Tommy, like, you know, play me some Motley Crue.
I hear some of those jumps, Tommy.
Girls, girls, girls.
I used to dance. Next thing you hear, Tommy Lee's in Scientology.
Vince, we can't go on a tour. I have to.
Julie break. Gets dismissed here. From,
so, do we even
Stubing.
Know what's happening? Have we talked about this? Well, Julie went to. Julie went to CL. What's
El Courtney?
Name? El Courtney's.
El Courtney's like an El Nino.
El Courtney's room, and so now Stubing barged in. Basically, he did the knock and turn,
knock, like, walk in kind of thing. Yeah,
yeah, he didn't. He didn't ask to be let in. He just knocked and came in, which I know we've talked about on many episodes before that. Cruise ship boats rooms, you can't do that anymore. You have to unlock.
Yeah,
you can't just walk into a room anymore. You have to wait for someone to open it up because they all automatically lock behind you from the outside.
We find out here that
mind dead.
Yeah,
we find out here
when
that
Christine locked you out. Yes. You're like, let me in.
Stubing's parents wanted him to be a surgeon, so it's, which is weird because if everybody wants him to be in the ship business.
And we know Stubing's dad was a boat guy.
Why would Stubing's dad want him to be a surgeon if he was a boat guy and wanted him to be a boat guy too?
I don't think they checked the Love Boat Bible when they were writing this episode.
I was just gonna say, that's definitely not.
It's a continuity error, as it were. Yeah, because Stubing definitely, his father was a World War II admiral, yeah. I think,
what was
right?
his nickname?
Stumpy?
Stubby?
Stimpy?
Stubby,
right? Yeah.
So
I just realized too, I never saw beyond this. I don't think I finished the episode.
It's almost over.
Yeah, I have.
What were you doing?
I just had the one.
I had to go pick up Carrie.
From where?
She was at a party on base, so I'm the only one who can get on.
Oh, so you had to go get? How'd she get on?
I took her.
Oh, so you're allowed to bring any terrorist or anything like that on there?
No. Did I have to do like background checks on her before she goes on?
No, they just needed it's called the Trusted Traveler Program.
Damn, man. I know how to get on.
That's going to be on the podcast.
You dropping your vape pen across the table or us talking about blowing up Fort Dix?
This is ether. You want some?
Ether?
That's what it's called, ether.
Get the fuck out of here. I'm not doing that. I got to go to work tomorrow morning. I got to work in like six hours.
You know who to give me a call.
I will do that. I'm in your corner, man. I'm rooting for you. Right. I'll be there.
Appreciate that. Okay, so Stubing, they talk about El Courtney here admits he's not a good dancer.
But he wants to be a dancer.
He also says that if dancing doesn't work, he might be willing to give the sea one more chance.
I don't think that's a cop-out answer because he doesn't
Stubing
like the sea.
Stubing even was like, he was happy for that, which I thought, really.
Like, if he can't actually dance, if he cannot be a ballet dancer, he should be in the ballet industry. Teacher,
maybe,
whatever.
Maybe he makes
some other kind of
designing his own leotard.
But I mean, like, he doesn't want to be a boat guy. He wants to be a dancer.
I want to see the boat movie.
It's there's other things to do besides actually dancing on stage. You can be involved in the production somehow else.
Yeah.
Everybody that is involved in a ballet, wanted to be a ballet dancer, and they've now been like, "Well, I can't do it, so I'll help. I'll do lighting."
I mean, even lighting, like, you're too tall to go up there.
Yeah, his body is not built for doing anything. But he can't be an admiral either. They shoot his head off the top of the boat. He needs to be you know, he's built to be a basketball player.
We missed the whole scene there. That was where Noreen tells Mrs. C that she Clark asked her to marry him
and
marry her.
And she
what?
Said that.
Marry
they just
him.
Met.
Yeah.
That was the second these two fell in love as well. That's
everybody
two couples right there, yeah.
Brian. This is the Love Boat. Everybody falls in love on a 2-day cruise here. There must be something in the water.
I don't know why he's surprised.
He is shocked by that. But I remember when she said that. She's like, "We're getting married." I'm like, what? I'm like, did you meet on a Friday and today's Saturday?
During that time, Mrs. C like has evil in her eyes.
Yeah,
she's just like, you're doing what?
I will end this relationship because now you're happy and I can't have that. My whole existence is to be better than you because that's really what it is. She had a whole life. She was married. Her husband died, I guess. And then I don't think she ever said anything about kids, but that's like,
she was the spinster,
always,
too.
She
right?
always had that over her. Yeah, the sister was the spinster.
Here was Bill just trying to tell
spinster. Spinster. fucked up, baby.
I keep thinking of Spinderella.
I'm thinking of Finster from Bugs Bunny.
Here, Bill's still trying to convince Stephanie to change her mind about turning him in. But she says she's got convictions.
And she's right. And he's stupid. He should run.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, she's hot, Mrs. Cotter. He can go to Rio. Yeah. Have you seen the Brazilian butt lifts that they're doing there now?
Also, he gets away with it. He's gone.
Yeah, she's not like she should have handcuffed him to the bed right there.
She even said that too. She's like, I should tell
Stubing. Yeah, if she really wanted to arrest him, she would have. She's giving every opportunity to leave by him just being free will. Like, yeah, I'll turn myself in when we get back. Can we finish our vacation first?
Did he leave with the money?
When he leaves and go to Rio?
He takes the money with him, I think. Oh. I don't think she has the money.
Well, I don't know if she... I don't think she does.
It was all over the bed when we last saw it, right?
Yeah, they show him putting it back into the case and zipping it up after that?
I don't remember if I saw that.
Nah, maybe not. Maybe not. And I don't care to rewind and find out.
It's all soaked in cum.
If that is not in the fucking clip of this show, you're fired.
100%.
You are fired.
The 100. That needs to be in the... That has to be. You can't mark it down right now what the time is. Time stamp that, right?
We missed the whole part where Mrs. C's sister was saying she couldn't marry the guy.
Oh, yeah. She says, what am I going to do? You need me. You need me. Yeah, she needs her.
It's really shitty.
They tell each other
a sibling to like throw that on a person. Like if my
especially
sister,
if the sibling was just pushing her to
but
get
if my
to
sister
somebody.
Ever said like you can't marry that person because I need you, I'd be like, I don't know. I mean, it's a stupid TV show, but it doesn't make a lot of sense. I can't imagine being in a relationship there where your sibling dictates.
Can
you
imagine
you
falling
do?
In love in 2 days on a love boat?
I can't imagine that. I mean,
I guess it depends on like if I was on the love boat with Julie for 2 days, I think I would.
Like, how long have I not been in a relationship? Because that probably dictates how long it takes for me to fall in love.
Let's say you were Juan Epstein and you were a virgin and you came on the boat.
And someone of Marsha Brady's looks.
Remember he was walking around with that hog like in those jeans?
Like a 1977 Marsha Brady, like a 22-year-old Marsha Brady came up to me. I'm probably in love as soon as she says, you're not disgusting. As soon as she says, how are you? I'm like, I will marry
she
you.
She was all over him. Yeah. Like she was like.
Well, I told you, she's a hooker for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But like if Marsha Brady, 1977 Marsha Brady walked up to me and even said, you know, your dick's hanging out of your pants, I'd be like,
what if
I need to marry you
what
now.
If 1978 Ava Gabor came up to you?
Yeah, I'm not a big Gabor sisters fan. Either
okay.
one, Zsa-Zsa.
Okay, darling.
Yeah, it's that Hungarian accent. Like, so pretentious. I want to hear, when I hear that accent, I want to hear Dracula talking like that. That's it. He's Hungarian, right? Or Romanian?
Isn't he Romanian? Yeah, or Transylvanian, right? It's in Romanian, same, or right? Transylvania is in Romania.
Is there any difference between any of those people?
I don't know, but Transylvania is a cool name.
It's a cool name. Nothing about, nothing will ever top the Simpsons back in the old days when the Simpsons was funny when they were doing one of the Halloween specials and like we're going to Pennsylvania.
How about when the Bundys went to Lower Uncton, England?
Oh yes, that was a multi-part episode.
That was good. I like that. Yeah. I was fighting.
I would have never remembered the name of that town if you had said where did the Bundys go. I would have been like, I don't know. They went to like England or something.
How
like
cool
that.
Was
Scotland.
That in Lower Uncton? Yeah. I know that. Yeah,
I would have not known that. I would have said Scotland probably because it was like, wasn't it always like foggy, like the moors of Scotland?
Well,
or something like that?
What happened
it was
wasn't it was cursed? It was going to be dark. That's why. Yeah,
I think I heard Brian off mic say it was cursed.
It was cursed.
There you go. There you go.
Mike was on. He just wasn't close enough that time, right?
When I can hear him through the headphones,
you're like
over there.
It's like. All right, so we had another pool scene.
Wait,
here.
I thought we were talking about married children. That was a rambunctious pool scene, by the way. They were all like dunking each other.
Lower Uncton pool? They did look like they were wild. They had the beach ball. But Julie says, oh, he left the, Bill left the boat a couple hours ago.
Yeah.
Didn't want her to tell Stephanie it was a surprise.
He wanted to go to a jewelry store.
Yeah, she thinks
like
it's going
to
be a surprise. She's like, don't tell him I told you.
Now, I'm not he should have converted that $1 million of cash into at least diamonds.
Do you think that's what he was doing at the jewelry store?
No, but it's probably easier to carry $1 million in diamonds than it is $1 million in $100 bills.
All he would need is like a little bag. It'd be like rubies and jewels and stuff like that. Yeah.
I don't know. I honestly don't know what $1 million in diamonds looks like.
I don't know. That one lady had that diamond on the boat. Remember
the Jim Neighbors one?
Yeah, but it ended up being fake.
Oh, no. Is that the Jim Neighbors one?
That wasn't the Jim Neighbors one. That was the one. Remember, they were going to throw it off the. They threw it.
That was the two-parter.
Oh, my God. Was that the last one we did?
We talked less for that one than we did for the episode that just half episode that posted today.
You've been in my house for 17 hours today. we're not even done with this episode.
Look how close we are, though.
How close are we?
That's close, right?
Yeah, we're in the 40s now.
And he figured his credits, too. So.
I know 17 hours is my usual go-to time.
Here,
for like
we longest. Got Gopher telling her that she couldn't use the phone because they were in port.
I noticed that, yes. Yeah. He's like, all the phones are unplugged until we
She's
get
like,
out
of
the
can I go use the one on the dock?
This makes no sense to me. Their phone system makes no sense to me.
I didn't understand it either. It still doesn't. But then
all our phones
she wanted
unplugged.
To go run out to the dock, but the gangway was up, so she couldn't do that.
Oh, did she say that? She wanted to go out?
She said, is there a phone? He said, yeah, on the dock. And she said, I'll go use that. And he said, the gangway's up, so she couldn't go out. She goes into her room, looks in her closet, like, because that's the first thing you do, look in your closet when you go back to your room. And you find a note.
Why would he leave that note on her bed or something like that, right? I mean, it's up on the top of the closet in the corner, perched up there because you're going to go there.
Because when you open that closet, the air, the breeze that you create isn't going to make that thing fall flat.
She could have never seen that note.
But the note basically said that he loved her and that if she ever was in Rio to look him up. I got a tear in my eye.
She should have gone. She should have been like, let me
said
off.
Love
and,
Bill. It said love Bill at the
no,
end.
No, it's love
the
boat, Brian. Jason. Brian.
Then we got Mrs. C talking to her sister here.
I don't know why Mrs. C's funny now. 4 hours into this podcast, but it's
but
funny.
She says that she sees something in her sister that she had when she was with Fred, her ex-husband.
Did she meet Fred in her 50s also?
I don't know, but Fred died. I guess he died young.
Well, she's not old here. She's in her 50s, I would say,
saying,
right?
Unless she was with an older guy. I don't know. We don't see a picture of Fred.
My heart kind of sank a little when I said 50 is not that old, because there was a time in my life where 50 was very old.
No, your heart didn't sink. That's you having a heart attack.
That might be. Now I think of 50, I'm like, oh, what a young buck at 50. Look at him.
I wish you were a buck. I could shoot you.
All right, Kyle, relax there.
So basically, Doreen saying no, but what about you and... Miss C finally coming back to how she originally was, like wanting her to find somebody. This is her time, she says. Go out. And,
I know every time we have a Love Boat episode, there's always like the one episode, the one segment where we're like, come on, this is that episode. This is that part.
Well,
of
this
the
is that. No, this that wasn't Ooh. Even the part. The part was where Mrs. C switches her mood completely.
But none of that matters. None of that whole thing's stupid. They got Marion Ross.
No,
to
but
be on
something
that
was weird.
The one
too,
with Mrs.
Like,
Cotter and the embezzler. That's
but
fun.
You have to admit that's really
and
weird.
What's that all about?
And close, like
That guy just sitting at the bar smoking a cigarette, just like in profile.
Real quick, he owned that guy Clark Tyler. He owned the old Tyler building. So what
he
like,
did
what
own
was that?
The old,
that was a weird connection.
And he's not
that.
Old.
Yeah,
I mean he's like 50 also.
But he
old,
I guess that was
the old Tyler building.
Probably his grandfather's building or something. Maybe
but he said he built it.
Oh, he built it too. That's right.
And he put in shitty floors apparently also.
Yeah, because he's gonna. He He'll can't have her walking on those broken floors.
But really, he built.
But that's your guy right there with the cigarette.
But this is such a weird
look. She's hardly wearing anything back there.
Yeah, good call. I saw the guy smoking up front. You saw the girl in the back.
That shows you what
that's
we're.
That's
got to
be
at.
Some kind of Rorschach test right there.
Yeah, we're gonna have that one. We're gonna have somebody look into that.
But he's just this guy's
tune into our Patreon
sitting,
for that episode.
This guy's sitting in profile, in focus. The action's happening behind him, and he's just sitting there smoking.
But
oh,
really,
man,
why did Bill
good.
Come back on the boat? Why did he come back on the boat?
She's got a magic vagina or something like that? Like, he's got to come back for her.
With the guy with the money?
Yeah.
He comes back?
That's him right now, yeah.
No, isn't this Marion Ross, this part here?
Isn't that Bill?
I don't know. These guys look the same.
I thought that was Bill, yeah.
You're pointing at him, and I'm still not sure that's not Marion Ross.
It's Bill and Stephanie.
Oh, it is Bill and Stephanie, okay. I thought it was the guy that was with Marion Ross's sister.
He has
sister.
Black hair.
Who the fuck cares? These guys look the exact same.
Well, first of all, he's got two first names, two Clark Tyler.
I really have no idea what these guys' names are at all during this whole thing. Stephanie and Bill. I got Stephanie and Bill. Yeah, I got that. I don't even know why.
Do you think she could tell one of like Cotter's uncle's jokes or something right there? And she did a Groucho voice.
So he never got off the ship, and he brought her a
champagne cocktail.
And she
said she's still
got
to do what she's got to do.
She's got to do what you got to do. And that's weak. You don't have to do what you got to do.
I didn't like it either.
They're back in town.
Phones are disconnected.
So she did get to arrest them.
We're not there yet. We're getting off the boat now.
Oh, okay.
And so now Marion Ross is so in love with
Clark here. This is Clark. He was insisting that Mrs. Ross live in the guest house that happens to be on his property.
And you know what? He never gave it to her, but what's his face? Cato Caitlin got that. Cato Caitlin? Is that
Cato
right?
Caitlin,
is that the
name?
Got that guest house later on.
OJ reference, because he was just in the news lately. Did you see he tried to kiss that girl and she turned her head? It was like a TikTok star or something.
I did not
That's
see
so
that.
Funny.
No.
She's like, OJ. And it was like, yeah, and they were like at a party and he turns to give her a kiss and her head just turns away. It's so great.
I was watching one of those Seinfeld clip, like 20 things of Seinfeld you didn't know on YouTube.
And you end up knowing 19
you know
of them.
All of them. You're like, oh, all right, well, whatever. Yeah, I know this. Like, oh my God, Kramer was based on one of the, okay, fine, whatever. But the episode with Joel Rifkin.
Oh, yeah.
Elaine's
serial
boyfriend,
killer?
Serial killer.
Joel Rifkin.
Yeah. And she's like, change your name. She's like, how about OJ? OJ's such a nice name. That is like 4 months.
Right, it was right before.
It's like 4 months before OJ kills his wife. Yeah. And I was like, it's so funny because at the time I'm watching, I'm just like, OJ? I'm like, who suggests that? But,
change your name to OJ Rifkin.
Yeah, but at the time, OJ was
okay.
He was fine.
He was still doing Hertz commercials.
And then months later,
Naked
he's
Gun
killing
movies.
His wife and... It's just so funny watching that in retrospect. You're just like...
He allegedly chopped her head off. Let's put it right. I mean, their heads are chopped
That's like
off.
Zach Stacy allegedly hit and his wife and as the TV fell on her head. Allegedly, that happened.
And their kids, her kids found it. Like,
and didn't his older daughter like stick up for him? Like,
It was weird there for a while.
How do those children look their father that killed their mother in the eye and say...
Hi, Daddy.
Yeah.
That's weird.
What's
yeah.
Father's Day like there? What's Mother's Day like? Hey, we're going to Mom's grave. Dad, you want to come with us?
Hold on.
Oh, no, it's all right. I said what I had to her in life. I said, you better not be dating that fucking waiter.
He's like, I guess I could slice out a few minutes for her. But I guess it was weird to hear because Marion or Mrs. C ends up not taking the guest house, right?
No, she's like, I can run the business, which is the dental business that I thought the other sister ran.
Yeah.
The other sister was the dental sister.
So she's saying, oh, she's getting married. She doesn't have to run that because this guy's...
I guess he's rich. And she's like, well, I can run
the
business.
Well, he's on the old Tyler building. He's got to have some money.
That old Tyler building, yes. When you're driving down Santa Monica and you turn right on 5th, that's the old Tyler building.
Are you doing
right
the, what was that, SNL skit? The Californians?
Oh, yeah.
Take the 405.
Devin, what are you doing here?
So
she doesn't want to live with them, but she'll run the business now.
Yes, and that ends that story. That's over.
I would have just been like, yeah, I'll live in your guest house and never do anything
the
ever
guest
again.
House is probably pretty nice, I would think. You know?
Do you have a TV there? Yeah? Okay, I'm good. I'll just sit there. Feed me twice a day. I'm good.
Julie was over the intercom saying it's a bank holiday.
And I was really like, why are we talking
and
about
said,
that?
If you want to cash your checks, cash them on the boat.
But then, of course, it becomes apparent that they said that just so we could say, oh,
set
it's a bank
up,
holiday.
This way, she's like, how can you get in your office at night?
Yep.
So this
they
way
don't even know you
in.
Stole that money yet. Yeah. It's not even a
But he, again, day. He backs out of that and says, no, I'm going to give it to him and tell them. Maybe they'll go easy on me, he says.
He says, like, why does he say he won't just turn the money in?
Because then it's going to be a cover-up, and he doesn't want to be a cover-up.
Oh, and she would be involved in the cover-up, right, yeah. So he'd rather
so he's
just
got,
turn
he
it
had
in.
Some really good morals that I wouldn't have had.
Especially for an embezzler.
Like
I've never embezzled anything.
Like,
out of
like for him to be like, this is my first time doing it. I embezzled $1 million. I like this lady. Yeah, let me turn myself in.
First offense. Guy's getting a slap on the wrist. He's not going to jail.
He's not going to Riyadh.
He's not going to jail.
So what, he didn't take the money?
He's going to bring gonna it back. In, yeah. He's going to bring it back and admit to it.
Rather than she gave him a way to get out. And here, the way he started, C or L Courtney.
He knocks down the watch over, your step sign because his head's so gigantic.
And he well, takes
he's,
it his with
head's
him.
Not gigantic. He's gigantic.
He takes it with him, and then Stubing just looks, that's my nephew.
I was thinking of getting a watch your step sign for my steps going down to the basement here. But that's my love boat sign there, the watch your step sign.
That's pretty cool. I would like
that's
that.
That's a deep cut.
I like it, though.
Yeah. Then I have to take my Slayer.
That was an episode. Again, it was a little tough getting through, I said, because the Marion Ross is really our only guest star that I really knew.
It wasn't that fun. It was just not a fun episode. I'd say.
You know why?
It wasn't a
you
dumb
episode.
You
know what was missing from this episode? Doc. You didn't get much
Doc. No crew members at all, really, were involved. Even though Isaac wasn't, like, you know, back in the background, he was involved, but. There's always some kind of crew interaction. This one had very little crew interaction.
I'm going to give us a cast list for next week. Jim Backus.
Oh, lovey.
Susan Blanchard. Not sure who that is off the top of my head. Paul Burke. Patty McLeod. Deborah Lee Scott. She was on... Deborah Lee Scott, she was on Police Academy. That's what I thought I knew her from.
Which one's she from Police
She's
Academy?
That girl from Police Academy.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Deborah Lee Scott.
The first movie, God. the original Police Academy movie, yep.
Laurette Spang, Sal Viscuso.
Jesus Christ, man. They have like been scraping the barrel after their star-studded two-parter. They're like, we have to cut budgets.
There's a lot of people there after those that are not in the alphabetical order, but... That's it. I mean, Jim Backus better carry this one for us, right?
That sounds terrible. I mean, really, that just sounds like a bad episode.
But like, skip. See, you know why?
Skip. Next week's episode will be skipped.
The one after that has.
No, don't do that. Don't do that. We can't do that because then we'll just start skipping. We really will.
Skip. But it has Patty Duke, Frankie Avalon.
Patty Duke again.
Barbie Benton. Jamie Farr, Ricky Nelson,
damn,
Carol White, Shelley Long.
Oh my God, they couldn't get Jamie Farr at least to like bump up 1 week and do that.
Oh yeah, that's gonna be a good one. All right,
So listen,
we also, I know we want to do the 1978 Star Wars Holiday Special, but we need to do that one soon because we want that to come out around in December, right, for the holidays, right? So. Come out after Thanksgiving, obviously.
Yeah, I will not be around. Well, no, I'll be around next weekend. We can do it next weekend.
All right, so
I won't be around on Thanksgiving Day, but I have to work Friday, Saturday, Sunday of Thanksgiving. So, but I'll be home. I'll be home in the
Saturday
afternoon.
Night then.
Yeah,
Saturday,
I mean, I work okay. today. I mean, yeah. I was home by 1 o'clock.
I said, if you need assistance, let me know. I mean,
no, you don't want to do what I'm doing right now.
But I'm willing to come in and help. Is what I'm saying. Take some stress off of people. That's what I do.
Oh,
that's what I
do. Well, then, let's go up to my bathroom after this. And
I'm the fixer.
Relieve some stress.
Anyway. Well, we're gonna watch that together, though, right?
How are we watching that? Is it on Disney?
I think I can get that.
I don't know if it's on YouTube. There's a holiday Lego special on Disney.
I watched like the first 5 minutes of that last year when it came out, and I didn't care. I'm not a big Lego guy. I mean, I like
the Lego movie.
I didn't like the Lego movie.
You know what was really
good? I didn't
good?
Like it.
The Simpsons Lego episode? That was really good.
Yeah, I guess I'm just not a Lego guy.
When Homer kept falling apart. It was just...
I mean, I liked the Lego Batman movie. I thought that was funny, but like the whole Lego aspect of it, I just don't care.
I forgot. We should do the ending here. This has been the Exciting and New podcast. We're Exciting and New on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. TikTok, right? You're on TikTok?
Oh, yeah.
And Jazoo74 at Twitter, AEGonzo1 at Twitter, Papa Bad Kitty at Twitter, and similar on our Instagram. I think Andy's AEGonzo70 on Instagram, something like that. And I'm Jason.
I'm Andy.
And I'm Brian.
How many people do you think hear us say our names again at the end?